I think we'll go ahead and get going. My name is Andrew Wilder. I'm responsible for the South and Central Asia program here at the U.S. Institute of Peace. And on behalf of USIP, I'd like to welcome you all, especially for some of our first-time visitors to the Institute. I'd also like to, in particular, thank our colleagues from the EastWest Institute. We're very pleased to be able to co-host this event with them today for the launch of their paper on Afghanistan Reconnected, Regional Economic Security Beyond 2014. And when we planned this event and this date, I think we had no idea that it would be such good timing, which I have to admit was luck and not planning, for three reasons. First of all, we actually have a new Afghan president and a CEO, and a few weeks ago that was looking like somewhat uncertain. So it is nice to actually be holding this event in the context of having a new government, and one that's actually proving to be quite active in its first 2 weeks on the job, and long may that continue. I think both President Ghani and CEO Abdullah certainly understand the importance of the region, regional politics, and the importance of greater regional integration for Afghanistan's own stability and well-being. And if any of you have the time, I would encourage you to read President Ghani's 309-page, I believe, manifesto, which has lots to say about the region in it. Secondly, we're holding this meeting just a little more than 2 weeks before the next the fourth ministerial conference on the Heart of Asia, so the Istanbul process meeting. That was scheduled for August 29th in Tianjin in China, but due to the fact that there wasn't a new government by then, it was postponed until the end of this month. And again, this will be sort of President Ghani's first sort of substantive foreign trip, and I think it's very fitting and important and symbolically important that it's going to be focusing on improved regional relations. Last but not least, just over the weekend, we had the signing by Afghanistan and Pakistan of the Transit Pricing Agreement for the Central Asia, South Asia, the CASA 1000 agreement, which it, when completed, CASA 1000 hopes to enable the Kyrgyz Republic and Tajikistan to sell some of their extra hydropower to fill gaps in Afghanistan and Pakistan. And anyway, I think some progress on this area of regional integration. I think we you know, again, a small step, but an important step over the weekend. But it's also many challenges remain, as you all know. I think we have to be clear-eyed about this and can't be Pollyannish about some of the challenges, which I would briefly say, first of all, starting on the Afghanistan domestic challenges. You know, will the new unity government be able to perform? Will it be bogged down in paralysis of internal fighting, or will it be able to agree on an agenda and move forward? And again, I think in the last couple of weeks, we've seen some very positive signs, many of them symbolic, but at this point, I'll take symbolism. I think that is important. But I think, you know, certainly if we have a maintenance of the status quo, it's hard to see a scenario where Afghanistan can truly become the heart of Asia. There's also very significant regional challenges, as we know. You know, will Afghanistan's neighbors, and I think Pakistan in particular, see their interests best protected by a stable and economically progressing Afghanistan, or are they betting that instability will prevail and that their interests will best be served by continuing to back proxies to protect their interests? In the last few weeks, we saw a sharp deterioration in Indo-Pakistan relations. I think that's not encouraging on this front. I think a lot of the problems we see in Afghanistan today can trace back some of their roots back to the Indo-Pakistan conflict. And unfortunately, that's not an area where we've seen tremendous progress. And that's going to be important if we're going to realize this vision. And last but not least, I think the international challenges are very significant. With the drawdown, sharp drawdown of international military and civilian assistance, will the international community remain engaged to the extent that they need to be, I think, to maintain stability in Afghanistan, which is going to be critical, again, to achieving this, this vision. So I think the vision can be achieved, but it will take really active commitments, both by the government, by the regional actors, and the international community to be realized. And that's, you know, why I think today's discussion is very timely and important. I'm going to end with a small advertisement. We at USIP are very concerned that now with the elections over, there's might be a danger of, in this town, of mission accomplished, letting Afghanistan slip far down on the priority list when there are many other competing priorities. And so we are planning, this is the first of a series of events this week, we're calling Afghanistan Week here at USIP, to again try to highlight the importance of Afghanistan moving forward, both in terms of U.S. national security interests, but of course for Afghanistan and the region in which it's situated. Today we have this event. Tonight we're hosting a small dinner in cooperation with the British Embassy to talk about the London conference coming up in November, which will also be a very important meeting, signaling both what the Afghan government, its reform agenda, and then what the international donors can do to support that. Tomorrow we're having Senator Carl Levin will be coming here to USIP to speak on the future of U.S.-Afghan relations in the context of the new government. And that's going to be very important, I think, in terms of how do we maintain a constituency of support for Afghanistan up on the Hill. And then on Thursday, we're having an event on social media and technology in Afghanistan and the important role that played in the democratic process. So I'd welcome all of you to come back again, both tomorrow morning and on Thursday for these other events. So with that, I'll end it and turn it over to Jim Creighton from the EastWest Institute. And again, it's a privilege to be co-hosting this event with you today. Thank you.
Andrew, thank you very much. And thank you to USIP, who in the 3 years that I've been with the Institute, we've done many things together. And it's always an honor to be here. Thank you very much. Also to the German government and the government of UAE, who helped put this together. They're our official sponsors. Thank you very much. And then as I look out through the room, I see many friends that have joined me in New Delhi, in Istanbul, in Islamabad, Brussels, and now in Washington, D.C. And our network is continuing to grow, and it's a pleasure to see so many people coming from around the world to talk to you about the opportunities that we see and the challenges that we see within Afghanistan. EastWest Institute is committed to building bridges and trust in places where bridges don't exist and there's not a whole lot of trust. And this is one of many efforts that we have ongoing to do that around the world. Over the last 2 years with the Abu Dhabi process, and we've convened meetings throughout the region with several hundred people participating at the ministerial level. But I think most importantly, also from the private sector, many CEOs and businessmen that are definitely engaged and want to move into the region. Now, we see our work as being complementary to the Istanbul process, as just the people that understand the region, they understand the opportunity, and are willing to work to make it happen. And those people coming together are supportive of the larger government entities. Where this report represents the end of phase one of the Abu Dhabi process. Phase one consisted of looking at what are the challenges and the opportunities, identifying specific recommendations to improve economic growth in Central Asia. And as we roll into phase two, and this is also the kickoff for phase two, we'll go back to New Delhi, we'll go back to Kabul, we'll go back to Islamabad and other Central Asian countries. We'll talk to government leaders with the information that we've gained here, with the input and participation of major business leaders and government officials. And the idea is that there is no silver bullet. You know, there's no fairy dust that you can sprinkle on these problems to fix them. But it's just good hard work and engagement and ideas that will help us bring Central Asia forward as the drawdown occurs. So phase two will mobilize this network that we've built. We'll take forward the ideas that we've come up with. We'll listen. We're going to the UN on Friday to do some more listening and discussing so that when we go, we have a consensus about small ideas that can lead to larger benefits. So what I'd like to do now is to turn it over to our regional vice president, who resides in Brussels. He runs our Abu Dhabi process, our Middle East, North Africa process. Ambassador Martin Fleischer, on loan to us from the German government. And sir, I turn the floor over to you and your panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jim, and good morning, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues. It's a pleasure and an honor for me, that's what you always say. It is, I think, a difficult task to moderate a panel with such distinguished experts here on the panel who are first experience and with an audience which I notice has 1,000 more time expertise about Afghanistan and the specific issues that I have. It is a great pleasure for me, and I'm really looking forward to engaging the experts on the panel with the many competent people that we have here in the audience. Let me briefly remind you the issue, the title of this event, Afghanistan Reconnected. Jim said Abu Dhabi process, that's another word for the same issue, Afghanistan Reconnected, regional economic security beyond 2014. So that's, we are not trying to solve the whole issues on the table for the future of Afghanistan here, but we try to find some very specific concrete, we try to identify concrete action that can help to improve cross-border trade, cross-border investment, and in that way also not only contribute to the economic development, but also to the security situations. Both are clearly intertwined, and that's why we choose as a working title regional economic security. But I will refrain from giving an introduction, knowing that you know much better what I would attempt to speak about. And Dr. Frederick Starr, you are a renowned expert in this field. You have produced a wealth of knowledge on this issue, but you promised me this morning that you would not do share this extensive knowledge with us, but just mention a very few concrete lines of action that where you see that this process, Afghanistan Reconnected, could be helpful. And without further ado, I would like to give you the floor.
Thank you very much. Let me begin by indicating four ways in which this particular project is distinctive. First of all, is the solid focus on trade and transport. These are not treated as two of 40 topics, but as the key drivers for economic development in Afghanistan, transport and trade. And this project puts that front and center. Second, the focus on what we might call the Southern Corridor, the great transport link that connected for 3,000 years India to Europe. We hear a lot about the New Silk Road, that the China-Europe link, but much older, much longer, much more heavily traveled, and also carrying, never interrupted, and carrying more ideas in both directions was the Southern Corridor. The effort here is to reopen it. This project has brought together people from most of the key countries along the route. This is really important. You can't do this without their direct participation. Up to now, that's rarely, if ever, been the case. And finally, fourth, and very significantly, it engages the private sector. None of this is going to happen without business people, and up to now, the focus has been on governmental and intergovernmental and agencies and financial institutions. They can talk about it, they can't do it in most cases, certainly not without the business sector. So hats off, I say, to this project and to its future. However, that said, up to now, it would seem to me the emphasis in dozens of international meetings has been talk. The product has been talk. It's been papers, commendable often, very worthy, but the product has been talk. And we're fortunate right at this moment to be able to shift gears into an entirely different phase in which instead of talking, we start doing. Now, for that to happen, two things are necessary. Obviously, engage the private sector much, much more actively. I wouldn't say engage, but even allow the process to be driven by the private sector. But second, also, for this to happen, you need to know what to focus on. And up to now, there have been 40 projects, all of them worthy, all of them defended in papers and presentations, but no prioritizing. What is needed at this point is to identify key drivers, key projects, and focus 100% on the most important of these, then move to the next one, then move to the next one. Any other approach from now on, given the positive developments in Kabul, is a waste of energy. Now, that said, the prioritizing is very important work. We did a paper at the Central Asia Caucasus Institute called Finish the Job, in which we attempted not only to prioritize projects, but to identify costs. That's worth looking at, but that's the kind of exercise that we'll need more of right now. Finally, let me say the following. Where does this all lead? And this is, I'd like to switch in the last minute and a half to from the very, very concrete and very practical to a more philosophical level. What is Afghanistan's possible future? Now, you know, ask yourself, you have in the back of your mind some kind of image of the future. What is it? And fears, too. Well, I would like to suggest that you compare Afghanistan at this moment with South Korea in 1953 when the armistice was signed. Very simply, South Korea was not a state, didn't even have a flag. Afghanistan is 250 years old. South Korea had ports, but was remote from trade routes. Afghanistan is absolutely centrally located. It needs roads and railroads. Third, South Korea had no resources, and it has no resources. U.S. government says Afghanistan has $1 trillion worth of natural resources. The Afghan government says $3 trillion. Finally, the Koreans in 53 had a very poor educational base. There's a very impressive rising generation in Afghanistan, many of whose representatives are here in this room. Given that, it seems to me, and let me end with this, it's an absolutely sober, realistic possibility, not an inevitability, but possibility that Afghanistan could become the South Korea of the 21st century. For that to happen, it needs very steady international support and very hard work, not only by the international community, but especially by Afghans themselves. Thank you.
Dr. Stahl, you have exceeded my expectation in being to the point and being very short. That's perfect. When you spoke about the Southern Corridor, the Southern Silk Road, I'm about to tell my adventures when I was 20 years old and drove all that way by car, but we'll do that later. And it's a fascinating region. Your last words were the Afghans themselves, and I think that is the perfect link to inviting Mr. Syed Mubin Shah. You have on your program, you see His Excellency, Muzamil Shinwari. He was supposed to be here. His Excellency, the new president, has convoked Mr. Shinwari for a strategic meeting, and so he had to cancel the last minute, and we are extremely grateful for Mr. Shah that he jumped in, not just as a substitute, as a very, very apt person to speak on this very issue. Mr. Shah, he was the Deputy Minister of Finance, and he is now a commercial counselor, a commercial representative for the Afghan government in various countries, and with his main seat in Washington and liaising with the government and the business community here in the United States. And he is the expert on the issue of economic regional security. And thanks once again, Mr. Shah. I think everybody here is grateful that you could make it last minute. I know you have a very tight schedule, but to quote Frederick Starr again, setting priorities is also an art that is required. So, Mr. Shah, please, you have the floor. Would you switch on the microphone?
Sure. Distinguished chair, delegates, ladies and gentlemen, the most respected and competent audience, good morning. So there is no need for introduction because I have been already introduced. On behalf of the government of Afghanistan and also on behalf of the deputy minister and on my own behalf, I'm delighted to be part of this important event hosted by the respected organization USIP. Thank you very much. So I am sure that such event will provide useful information to the relevant stakeholder, policymaker, and decision makers. Today, as I know, the topic is political transition and security situation and what are the challenges and opportunity in Afghanistan. So Dr. Starr, I know him from the very past year. He's expert on Afghanistan, and we work together in different in Karak and Central Asian forums. When I was frequently also participating in that meeting of these 10 countries. Coming to the security situation, so if we see before political transition, the security situation was deteriorated exactly. People lost their hope for stability. Economic activity was downward sloping due to the delay of announcement of election result. And people were frightened to send their children to school. People were looking to the history that they were thinking that no political transition without bloodshed. But despite all such serious concern, now we have successful political transition in Afghanistan with the National Unity Government. Now hope is strong. The hope in strong government is raising up. Hope about stability is also raising with among the people. Hope about the changes is growing up. Positive expectation is moving up inside Afghanistan among the common people. And these those are the people who are determining the situation in Afghanistan. Again, people are sending their children in, without any fear to the schools. The life started with the hope that Afghanistan will regain the dignified and honorable stage which was in the previous time. Of course, this was seemed to be difficult without the help of the United States and its ally. And therefore, it's a place to give a heartfelt thanks to all those contributed to safe political transition and without happening any bad events. And let's give a big applause and appreciation to this safe transition, which we had it actually. Yeah. Yes. Comparing the situation before and after the political transition, so before political transition, we Afghans and our partners were regretted in losing hopes of stability, but the hope and expectation has started to building again after the transition. Number two, and this is a positive factor I want to tell you because some of the people thinking what's the backside of the coins. So before political transition, the security situation became worsened. Insurgent group like Taliban and other forces and their supporter were motivated as the political choice among us, they were giving a motivation to the opposition forces in order to advance in war. But after the political transition, in the political transition itself was a slap on their face and barrier for our enemy to succeed in advance. And you can see the news, despite some minor event is happening, but the security situation in Kabul and the provinces has improved a lot. Security forces are motivated in advancing step by step to improve the situation. Third, there are many causes and reason for the fragility status in Afghanistan. Corruption is the biggest one, which is seriously taken by the current government. Kabul bank issues, reaffirm of the general prosecutor office, current, etc., are the starting examples. This combating corruption, I mean, will help in diverting people from war to the involvement in the productive activities, if well managed. Four, in addition, the current government is focusing on a comprehensive, effective planning for security improvement, as the president said this when he was talking to the security forces. Five, signing a security agreement with the United States and NATO had contributed already to the security, and it will contribute lastly and finally to the safe and successful economic transition as well. Coming to the national unity government, when we call it national unity government, the people always think the backside of the coins and think unity government as a challenge. I think let's change such approach in case of Afghanistan. Let's think how we can transform such challenges into opportunities that can be availed. Number two, people are thinking that the two parties or two sides are working on division of government position. But the reality is not like that. Rather, currently both sides agreed in principle to recruit people based on the knowledge, experience, and skill. Each group has highly qualified people, either Dr. Abdullah and Dr. Ashraf Ghani. In both sides, we have good qualified people. Without having a unity government, one group of qualified people may not be sufficient for optimal running of the public administration. That is why the combination of qualified professional will together meet demand of the public administration in relative terms. That is in relative terms. It means we have high demand for qualified people. Once the two sides think they are the owner of the government, it will lower the level of unrest in Afghanistan and build trust of the people. People of Afghanistan is tired of unrest. Opposition in Afghanistan context, I saw the demonstration here in Washington, D.C. It was very peaceful. But in Afghanistan, it means some destruction, some killing, some injuries. So we don't need that one. So we need unity, actually. The fourth thing is the government is working to strengthen transparency and accountability. This will help further strengthening the unity and enable the environment for public and private investment in economic growth, which is positive steps toward economic transition. Four, the positive competition in reform and check of one group on other will result in improvement. This is another positive thing in the unity government. The other positive thing is, the other things, however, I don't reject the availability of culprits and puppets of our enemy among each group and can remain as a challenge for the time being. It may result in delay of reform, but cannot bring major deteriorations in the government system. However, we are facing the challenges, as Dr. Starr said, that we are talking much but working less. The economic transition. Even about the document of the Tokyo conference, which is talking about the political and long-term stability, fiscal sustainability and fiscal self-sufficiency. That was at that time, I think, 2025. And then it was revised, the document, and something has happened in that one. But I think this is also a challenge. The two main factors are in fiscal sustainability are just creating problem. Unless the Afghan are very proactive, I can say very active when they start a work. The corruption is a problem, and also the systematic problems within the government process. this bureaucratic procedures and all other things. So if this is removed, and we have to, this is the challenges, and the government is addressing this one. The second things in the challenge is the withdrawal of foreign troops, because there are many things I don't want to discuss in this, can be a separate discussion at this point, but they have employed thousands of Afghans. When the this foreign troops withdraw, so the thousands of people will remain unemployed. The government and its partner has to address these things, and that is also a challenging. Convincing our partner, this is the third challenge, to continue with the building upon whatsoever we have done. And that was the aims of the security agreement and the other agreement, to continue to keep our sustainable mode in the development process and continue until the plan end of the economic transition. The government and partner has to discuss and come up with a solution. Four, enabling environment challenges, which everybody is talking about actually, this is very important. The Korea example, in 1953 to 55, it was completely destroyed and there was no resources. What they have done actually selected the in and outward looking development strategy and by attracting domestic and foreign investors. And now we see Korea where it is. And I think it will happen here. So the enabling environment is including many issues. We can say combating corruption, improving security, access to electricity, access to land, trade facilitation, trade policies, and a couple of things. I would like to also say to the response to Dr. Star related to the, I think nobody has worked related to what are the people priority areas in Afghanistan. If this happened, and they have actually started writing on these issues, this will also help a lot, building the gap between the people and the government. What are the national priority areas? And what are the economic priority areas? These are the challenges and the things I think some research institute can help Afghanistan to, what's a fix, even we are at the stages of emotion that we are going forward, that we say we want to start something. As he mentioned, the North-South Corridor is one of the important projects. And there is way, actually, and I'm myself here are pushing for that one in order to find some ways, and we'll be also writing in report to the Afghan government, Ministry of Finance, and I was talking, and I have sent several emails related to that one, that how we can push from this side. Because sitting us silent will not help. Five, strengthening the there are some opportunities. You see, the as Dr. Star said, that being Afghanistan as a hub and its location in the heart of Asia, it's which connect the South and Central Asia together, that's itself an opportunity to be aware. Similarly, existence of political will. This is an opportunity which is emerging at the current time. It has to be availed. And growing expectation of the common people, this is an opportunity to be availed. Availability of huge investment resources are opportunities availed, to be availed. Sorry for taking much time, and I think I have to end with the words that let's be together and addressing together all these issues, because the countries of the world like part of human body. If a part has got a problem, the whole body will be not stay silent. Rather, eye will be tearing and the mouth will be crying. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Shah, for this enlightening and and also very very personal, very emotional plea for cooperation, and we need to stand together. Next I would ask Mr. Jonathan Carpenter from Department of State, Deputy Special Permanent for Afghanistan and Pakistan. I don't know, John, we are under Chatham House rules, and could you perhaps begin with your very personal feeling? Is the glass half full? Is it half empty? The future of Afghanistan? this audacious comparison with South Korea, which I find, yes, audacious, as I've said. Maybe you would like to start off with that.
Thank you. Thank
you very much, and thank you to everyone for joining us today. I am particularly struck by not only USIP's continuing engagement on Afghanistan and the work that Andrew outlined that they're doing this week and they've been doing for years to build shared understanding and a broad consensus of kind of what we're collectively trying to achieve in supporting Afghanistan's continuing transformation. But the East-West Institute's effort here to bring in multiple stakeholders, the private sector, the region, I think is a really valuable contribution, and I'm glad for that, and I'm glad the process continues. I may defer to the end on the half glass, half full, half empty comparison, if you don't mind. But let me say, I will try to be a little personal and also a little quick on this. First of all, when I joined SRAP in 2011,
When I joined SRAP, sorry for the
acronyms, right? It's a State Department habit. Forbidden. When I joined the State Department's Office of the Special Representative in 2011 for Ambassador Grossman, the first person he sent me to see was Fred Starr to figure out exactly how the new Silk Road and the regional connectivity piece that Fred was promoting, how we could, in the effort that Ambassador Grossman was pressing on regional connectivity, how we could better marry these up, and how we could learn from all the research that Fred had done in the region, and his incredible both knowledge and contact. So I'm glad to be sitting here next to him. I'm also wary that when Fred says there's too much talk and too little action, that being the State Department guy, that puts me in a bad spot. But nonetheless, 2011 was when Secretary Clinton first talked about the new Silk Road, and we launched this idea in the context of a number of engagements, including the Heart of Asia process that the Afghan government, along with the Turkish government, launched at that time. The effort of sort of talking in a regional sense on an economic basis was somewhat new. It was new at least in government. It wasn't new in academia or in the private sector. It also wasn't new to Afghans, of course. So my first trip to Afghanistan in 2011, I actually called on Deputy Minister Shinwari. I'm sorry he's not here today. Yeah. And saw on his wall a poster promoting the Afghan-Pakistan Transit Trade Agreement, if you remember this from a few years ago. Deputy Minister Shinwari's poster had Afghan farmers and carpet weavers and other people. It had trucks passing through Pakistan, and then it had people in a market in India. And this was very much sort of front and center the vision of the Afghan government of Deputy Minister Shinwari personally. And I know he's done a lot since then to advance this agenda. And I'm sorry he's not here, but I'm very glad for the intervention that we've just heard. I would also say that I know the next panel, I believe a colleague from our South Central Asia Bureau, Fatima Sumar, will be here. So I won't do a tremendous amount on the kind of engagements in the region, although we can talk about that, because Fatima, Assistant Secretary Biswal, and her team are doing a tremendous amount on this, not least the work to support the CASA 1000 signing, the CASA 1000 project, the signing of which was commented on earlier in this context. Looking back to that time, I we've spoken about the three transitions a lot in our conversations about Afghanistan: the security, political, and economic transition. I think we've remarked the least on the economic transition for obvious reasons, but I think now that's sort of rushing to the front and center. At least it was rushing to the front and center. It was sort of set. Moved to the background for a few months while the political transition was sorted out. But I suspect over the coming weeks and months, this will be a focus for many commentators. The reality is that the United States and our partners working with the Afghan government have done a tremendous amount here to set the conditions for success in Afghanistan. I won't take the time, because I know it's limited here, to go through the details of where Afghanistan has come since 2001, but it's really a remarkable story. And when you read the press articles about assistance and, the challenges and how hard this is, that's all true, of course. but it cannot mask the fact that real progress has been achieved, and that progress is fundamental now over the course of a generation of Afghans in changing opportunities. In the context of what we're talking about here, Fred talks a lot about trade and transit. I agree, and the infrastructure that's gone into place in Afghanistan over the past decade is remarkable. I was in New York at the General Assembly and heard the Foreign Minister of Kazakhstan refer to Afghanistan in 2001 as an economic cul-de-sac. And if you looked at any maps at the time, that's exactly true. All the rail and road connections ended, whether from the north or the south, they ended. And there was a sort of black hole of 30 years of conflict that was Afghanistan in the middle. And that's changed. That's changed in a really tangible way. There's much more to be done. But when you think about what the ring road is, we focus a lot on connections within Afghanistan. But if you sort of squint at that map, what you realize that the ring road is in fact sort of a hub and spoke connecting the whole region together, knitting the whole region together, right? It allows trucks that enter from Tajikistan to get to Pakistan. It allows trade from Uzbekistan now on the first rail line into Afghanistan, right? That connection from Hayratan to Mazar-e-Sharif, built with the support of the Asian Development Bank. So there's been, you know, significant movement. I would say from our perspective now, you know, the shift for us has been over the past few years has been to a focus on sustainability. And I think this is the real challenge now in the Afghan context. The challenge is that with our assistance levels declining, still very robust and a tremendous amount of money to be spent, but really declining from the high water mark of 2010 and 2011, how do we move these very real gains? How do we make them sustainable? I think this is the biggest challenge for this new Afghan government, and we as donors and partners to the Afghan government need to figure out how to do that in a very tangible way. As I said, we still have a significant amount of money available for this, and I'll finish very fast here. Let me say this. First, I would ask everybody to focus on this London conference that's been remarked upon already. The Brits who are organizing this, along with the Afghans, have organized three side events beforehand. It won't surprise you that they are with the private sector on regional engagement and on civil society, right? And there's no debate about the importance of those efforts. Two, we have to focus on the business environment inside Afghanistan, right? So as much as everyone's going to talk about security and concerns about insecurity and all that, the reality is that businesses, both Afghan and international, have ways to deal with that. You know, if you talk to a large multinational firm, they do business in plenty of physically insecure environments. They know how to handle that. What they can't handle is regulatory insecurity and political insecurity. That's where, when they talk to us, that's the number one challenge that they identify. So looking at things like the criminalization of commercial disputes and the challenges that poses in the Afghan context is right. And three, in that respect, you have to look at commercial financing moving forward, right? So there still is significant donor funding from the ADB, from the United States, and others. And our commitment to Afghanistan, you know, is longstanding and beyond the end of the troop presence that the president announced, of course. When you talk about a shift to a normal embassy operation in 2017, that is larger than that. And so that commercial financing, I think, is going to be critical. The banking sector, those are the areas now that we need to support the Afghan government as it moves to make progress. And I'm getting the look, so I will cease. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I was hesitant to cut you off because you came in the very end to what we really are all looking for, very concrete recommendations, points to start with. We will try to reflect those in our summary, in our report. I have to say that I was corrected by my staff. This is not under Chatham House rules. This is a public discussion. Mm-hmm. I hope this will not hinder you. So I really put you on there. I'm sorry for that.
That's
right. But to encourage you, I survived 25 years in the diplomatic service, saying what I think and thinking what I say. My wife wonders how this was possible, but it is possible. So let's not be afraid and continue to be outspoken. I would like to introduce my dear colleague, Dr. Philip Ackerman. Philip, if I'm not mistaken, you had more or less the same position that John has in the US government. You had it until recently in the German government as a deputy, a special representative or head of task force for Afghanistan and Pakistan. So you have you have actually been part of setting the ground rules for German engagement, especially in when it comes to civilian reconstruction. And so you're personally have been, and I'm sure you still are, very engaged. And also, of course, the German government, as you know, is the second largest troop contributor, or at least it was. It still is. So I'm not fully up to date. By the way, the last time that I was in Afghanistan was 2004, and we had this 10 years ago. I hope things have changed for the good. But when we talk about security, I was then heading an effort for setting up a truck workshop that the German Federal Army set up to support the build-up of the Afghan National Armed Forces. But this in brackets, so my knowledge is outdated, yours is much more topical, and although you are now the deputy to the German ambassador to the US, I'm sure you're very it's a welcome opportunity to talk about this previous field of work to which you have helped to conceive. Philip, you have the floor.
Thank you. Actually, it is a pleasure to speak, and I'm still very much engaged in Afghanistan. Is a matter that doesn't leave you easily, so it's something which is very much on my mind. Let me say that I was well known in the German Foreign Office as being a notorious optimist when it comes to Afghanistan. And when I listen to Dr. Starr here, I must say my role here seems, I mean, Afghanistan is the new South Korea. I'm not totally convinced that we are going there very quickly, but I wish, of course, that might become the reality one day. Let me say that we have seen, from a government perspective, we have seen that the new president in Afghanistan seems to be very determined, and he has some very, very clear and good ideas, and he has started with a quite impressive amount of initiatives. I just mentioned the Kabul Bank initiative. He's reopening the case on the Kabul Bank, and he's revision some laws, the mining laws, for example, that may make them more investor friendly. I think President Ghani somehow understood that in order to become South Korea in a while, he has to get two things going: the economy and good governance, stability for the country. Now, I'm a firm believer that government engagement in Afghanistan, or the engagement of the international community rather, is crucial for the next couple of years. And therefore, my government also has pledged and is committed to stay with Afghanistan in the next couple of years on very many levels. What is the task to take up Dr. Starr's appeal to act rather than to talk and to write papers? What is the task of the international community when it comes to set up Afghanistan, set on this path of better economy, better governance, stabilization? I would say 4 points, and I'll be very brief. First of all is we have to start in supporting this government of national unity. Actually, we have to say there is no government at the moment. We have a president, we have a CEO, but we have no government. So we have to support the Afghans to come up with the government as quickly as possible. Now, my country has is ruled by a grand coalition, as you know. So the big opponent parties got together and formed the government right now. Germany is a much duller place than Afghanistan, let me assure that. And I can tell you that a grand coalition is, even in Germany, not an easy task to administer. So I would say the international community has to support Afghanistan in order to get this government of national unity going very strongly. You know, we have to remind President Ghani that he has committed himself to this government of national unity, and he must not leave at any price out the other part of the government. That's the first thing. The second thing is the government has to live up to its initiatives. You know, when we see what President Ghani has started. Now this has to be implemented also, and we have to escort him, so to say, in the way of really making things happen that he started now. And the London conference, Jonathan was talking about, is certainly one of the most pivotal events in this context. We have to get clear messages from the Afghans what they want from the international community and how they intend to use what they get from the international community. And so far, I have been at Tokyo myself. We have made good starts in Tokyo. We have produced good papers. The papers are not entirely fulfilled, if I say so, may say so. So we have to get London at a better level of implementation and realistic approach to what's going to happen. Now, in the medium term, I would add two other things which are of utmost importance. First, we need a new push for peace and reconciliation with the Taliban, with the opponent group, the rebel groups. Stabilization is one of the preconditions for economic development, and we need this economic development. We need to get the other side in the political process. And we have had some good efforts, we have had some first steps, and I think our American colleagues here, to who I must say goes a lot of credit, also when it comes to the forming of the government of the national unity. It's really the Secretary Kerry and Jonathan, your team, and Dan's team have to be commended for that. It's really an excellent job. But we need this new push for reconciliation. We have seen yesterday again a terrible attack by the Taliban in Saripul, a province which is rather calm in the north. So I think stability, we are still far from a stable situation. We need to get over this civil war, which is not a civil war, but this violence in the provinces. And the fourth point I'd make is we need to reform the electoral system. And their electoral system. And this has been agreed upon in the forming of the government of national unity, but it's a very ambitious project. And I think what we see now is that the plans are perhaps a bit overambitious. Yeah? In 2 years' time, we want a totally new constitution. So. But we need to sit down and talk with the Afghan government and with all the parties of the Afghan government in order to reform the political system. It has become very clear that the electoral system we had is not really working in Afghanistan. I hear that President Ghani, and again I must say congratulations that he took this initiative, has sat down with the UN on this already, and I think that's a very, very good first step. But we have to be really close to the Afghan government and look and support them in what they are doing in order to get that done. Now, my last point before I close, I think that the German government has, as I said at the beginning, has decided to stay committed in Afghanistan for a long time. Financially, we are part of this troop financing trust fund to a large extent, but also in the development area, but also militarily. We are still the second largest troop contributor, thank you, and we will stay in Mazar-e-Sharif for a certain while, even in the north of Afghanistan, in order to keep this spoke north running. We feel, and that's where we perhaps, if I may say so, differ a bit from our American friends, where we normally are very much in sync with, but we feel that the reduction, the down to zero by the end of 2016 might be a little premature. We think that we might reconsider this at a certain moment. But having said that, Afghanistan, and now I'm coming back to my more optimistic approach to the whole affair, I think we have come a long way in Afghanistan. I've been dealing with Afghanistan for a very long time, I must say. But where we are now, with all the setbacks we have seen also in the last month, we are much better than in 2004 when you were in Afghanistan last time. I think there is a perspective for a prosperous and working and stable Afghanistan, and even it's not if it's not South Korea in 5 years, but let's take a part of India or something, which is more realistic. But if we are there in 5-10 years, I think I would be very happy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Philip. That leaves us with some hope and. But a vast area of problems. I'm happy that you have all been so disciplined, because we have a full half hour now for discussion. That's excellent. Thank you for that. I have two options. I can go right into the audience, or perhaps I would allow, if there is one or two questions on the panel to what you have said. You would? Okay. If that is not the case, but you, I'll give the floor to each of you again for some final, we are in the middle of the process, but for some concluding remarks from your point of view. So I would perhaps be happy if in the end you would name one or two things that you would recommend that we carry beyond this today's workshop. If that is the case, then I would like to open the discussion to the audience. I see we have somebody here with the microphone. That's excellent. And so if you have questions or comments, I mean, then you are more than welcome. And perhaps you would say to whom you direct the questions. Just we take three or four questions. I think the gentleman here in the middle, at the Yale, was the first. The gentleman over with the blue shirt. If you would give your name. Yeah, if I forget somebody, then remind me. Okay, I'm trying to remember two or three people. It's just too many. And maybe you also try to see who was first in raising his hand. Yeah, if both of you help me with that. If you, in the name, beginning, please say your name and your affiliation, and then try to limit your question or comment on like 2 minutes maximum.
Sure, don't worry. Sarang Shidore, University of Texas at Austin. Question is to Ambassador Philip Ackerman. I think you brought up the elephant in the room, the only speaker, the Taliban, which I think are very much active in Afghanistan, still have not been vanquished. Perhaps they can be reconciled. But my question was really regarding that political process between the government and the Taliban. There are certain indications that Pakistan has sheltered and harbored many of the groups that are active in Afghanistan. And I was wondering what sort of signals is the German government sending to Pakistan to bring some kind of a bridging between the two sides? What are their red lines? What would be the preferred German solution? Thank you.
Thank you very much for being so concise. That's the way we can have several questions. Did you see who was I saw the gentleman here, two more gentlemen. There was one lady, who was it, asking for the floor? She has, okay. At least we have two gentlemen here, and the one at the aisle here. Please give him the microphone. And then, yes, and the other gentleman will be next.
This question is from Mubin Shah. My name is John Rothenberg. I'm an Afghanistan specialist. In my most recent job, we did an evaluation of MULSA's support to martyrs and disabled. And we found that 14% of the revenues of Afghanistan are being used for this program, and it has the potential of using 80%. There are several other what I call vampire programs in Afghanistan's budget. We were told that if Ashraf Ghani became president, these kind of things would be dealt with when we were studying it. I'm wondering if there's anything having been done yet.
Can I ask again, your question was directed to whom? To Mr. Shah, okay. Thank you. Then we have the gentleman here.
Thank you. My name is Omar Ulumi. I'm from Afghanistan. I'm here today under the Ramsfield Foundation, and I'm a fellow of the foundation. My question is to both Ambassador Philip and also John. Looking at or hearing Dr. Starr's speech, that we have too much on the paper, but there's not really an action. We're not really doing much to put those to action and implement them. And I also see Dr. Philip saying that he's not very optimistic to see Afghanistan of the next Korea. I think if we have those still on papers, I'm not sure we'll see it, but John also said that there is a significant amount of money And there is a significant amount of plans and that we need to put into the real action to get this accomplished. My question would be mostly to John. Why is he not optimistic to see Afghanistan the next Korea? Thank you.
Okay, I have one more question. That would be the lady in green at the aisle, and then I would close here for a round of answers. Can we please have a microphone in the middle?
Good morning. My name is Hannah Schulder. I'm a scholar of urban
planning.
Can
you get the microphone a little closer?
Thank you. And conflict resolution. So I have a question and a comment. Basically, the discussion about the private sector investment in Afghanistan, I think it's incredibly important if you want, you know, economic growth. But then linking to the issue of stability, I think one of the key issues is economic inequality. And so I'm trying to understand, maybe you can provide your comments and insights about how such investments in the country's, you know, businesses and resources can actually address the issue of economic inequality for the purpose of stability in the country.
Excellent. Thanks very much. Okay, I take one more, but just for gender equality. And because then I would like to have a round of answers.
Thank you so much. My name is Zakia, and I'm from Afghanistan too. Actually, I'm doing my intern with the World Bank, and I read the report that they did on Afghanistan's mining, and I noticed that the economic development from that part of view is not participatory enough from the people elements. And how I wanted to know if, since the new president is an anthropologist, whether there is going to be any strategy to make sure that the economic development is taking the people's participation into the process. Thank you.
People's participation in what?
In the economic process. For example, how we make sure that people's needs are addressed and if they are affected, how.
Okay. So then let's try how we get this organized. I would perhaps, the question, why Philip is not convinced that Afghanistan will be the future Korea, I would like to turn that question around. That would be unfair. I would like to ask Frederick briefly, why you have this hope that Afghanistan could be the future Korea. And I've been in South Korea too as a student, and these are very different countries and with a very different political and economic and historical background. So please.
First, you can compare anything to anything.
Thank you. We'll take that into conclusions.
Second, I didn't say it will be. I said it could be, and I offered four very specific factors that favor Afghanistan in this comparison. And then and these are extremely important. However, I just to repeat myself, said that this won't happen automatically. I did not say it will, I said it could. And this will depend on very hard work, and it will depend, and I go back to what Dr. Ackerman said, I think it has to be underscored three times. The key ingredient, in addition to South Koreans being Koreans, is that the United States and Korea, as in Japan, as in Taiwan, as in Germany, stayed the course. And even today is providing a security umbrella. If we're not willing to do this, I would ask you, what sensible investor on this planet would invest $90 billion and sacrifice 2,500 lives of its citizens and then walk away from the investment? We didn't do that in Korea, and that's a key ingredient. So without that, I can't see that this grand possibility is attainable. So I emphatically agree with Dr. Ackerman.
Because I think Dr. Starr is totally right. We have, if he compares South Korea in 2014 with South Korea in 1953, it's we have more than 60 years difference, and you know, I don't know what's going to happen to Afghanistan in 60 years' time. But what we need to know is what's going to happen to in Afghanistan in 5-10 years' time. That's very important. So perhaps the South Korean bar is very high, but I think the sort of Gujarat bar or Punjab bar is not that high. So I think actually, don't make me a pessimist. I wanted to say I'm an optimist on Afghanistan. I'm very, very confident on Afghanistan. And let me tell you one example why I'm confident in Afghanistan. That goes to your question. When the mining law came up, the German business community, which basically is not very interested in Afghanistan because it's too dangerous, it's not stable enough, was at least interested in this mining law. And as you know, everything takes time in Afghanistan, even electing a new president. But in this case, it took a long, long time until the mining law passed the parliament. And we were pushing for it, and we said, you know, we have to have this mining law. Now, all of a sudden in Berlin, when I was in my previous function, a civil society organization came to my office and said, listen, we are an Afghan civil society organization fighting to improve the mining law. And we influence female members of parliament of the policy jirga in order to make this law more population friendly, to involve the villages more, to bring the people more on board, to give them rights in saying. And what they said was so entirely convincing in you know, in Afghan civil society, was so clearly good for the law, that I thought, you know, perhaps we better wait a bit. Yeah? Perhaps we better wait until the Volasi Jirga really has made up its mind in order to know how this law must look like. And that's a reason why I am confident in Afghanistan, because in this country, there has been a movement of civil society which becomes more and more powerful. There are groups, you know, independent groups outside the political actorship that are really engaged and committed to something. And the mining law now is under revision again, and I think it's a good idea to revise it again. But you know, the moment that the society is taking part in all these procedures, not only the parliamentarian but also civil society, it's a very good sign. So please don't make me a pessimist when it comes to Afghanistan.
Thank you very much, Philip, because I think you twice, because you have already answered the question from the young lady in the rear there about people's participation. That was, we had two questions overlapping, but at
you
least
can't you thank me enough, it's fine. Go on thanking me, it's fine.
At least yes, I thank you for answering the question on people's participation with a special view to mining. That was first impression. There was a question that I must admit I did not fully understand, directed to Mr. Shah about vampire budgets. Please explain what this is.
I think he was talking about the allocation of the revenue or in the budget, something to the economic burden to be beared by this. So we know that due to the long war and destruction which has happened in the previous time, and it left disabled, widows, and orphans, and all other things, and the government has to address that issues due to the available situation to comprehensively look to the political, social, and economic situation. And you know, this economic burden, every government want to decrease. It is desirable. And even at that time, in the previous time, some steps has been taken how to decrease this burden. And the disabled were allocated, were evaluated, and some people within the disabled community, which has listed by the Ministry of Social Work, that was also employed in different ministries, and that is how they were contributing and also solving their problem and also decreasing the government. There's 16 days to say that what is the new initiatives, so let's see what will happen.
John, you want to that?
Yeah, I'd like to pick this up a bit, because I think this is, I appreciate that, and I think this is going to be an increasing focus for us and our engagement with the Afghan government, and I would just point to the recent visit over the past week or so of new National Economic Advisor Minister Zakawal, the acting Minister of Finance, former Minister of Finance, who came to the World Bank IMF meetings really on the back of the very positive initial steps by President Ghani to reopen the Kabul Bank investigation, talking actively now about a new IMF program, engagement with IMF, and donor governments on technical assistance in these critical areas. I think this is an important part. In addressing this, you know, fiscal gap, this revenue shortfall that's going to be a real attention grabber for the next few weeks and months, you know, a critical part of this now is going to be Afghan ownership of their expenditures, because I feel like, you know, to my point that the gains have been real but not sustainable, the budget is very much the same way, right? The budget in Afghanistan has not been a realistic budget now for some months, for some years. And so the Afghan government taking ownership of this, and we have every confidence that President Ghani fully intends to do this, will give donors the confidence here to step in and meet these needs that are substantial and ongoing, but in a realistic way, as you say, expenditure spiraling out of control that sort of got the budget from the inside.
Yeah. Thank you for that clarification. I think that's really a big challenge in these transition economies. I think we have had similar cases, for example, the building up of Palestine, where this budget issue is really critical for maintaining the confidence of the donor community and the investors. Thanks for that clarification. I have one more question left from this round.
Taliban.
Yes, the elephant in the room. And I'm sure you all have a lot to say to that, but who wants to begin?
Let me very quickly give you some words on this Pakistan-Taliban issue. I mean, we have seen that Pakistan is very important in this whole equation. You know, I mean, there have been many, and if not the most, the leadership of the Taliban sits in Pakistan and is there. We have seen that Pakistan has changed its attitude toward the Taliban. I think it went from bad to better than bad. Now, as we know, better than bad is the new good. In so far, we should not be too unhappy about that. But let me say this in this context: don't externalize this conflict too much. The Afghans have to reconcile with the Afghan Taliban. Pakistan plays a role, but not the over important role people are attributing it to. I think we need now a sit together with the Taliban and the Afghan leadership in Kabul, and we know that this must be mediated somehow. It's not going alone, but I think we have to see this is an Afghan conflict within the Afghan population. Don't attribute too much to Pakistan. We talk to Pakistan all the time, and I think the Americans do it even more than we do on this.
Yes. I would just quickly add to that. I wouldn't add actually a word to that about the need for Afghan leadership and the fact that the Afghans are going to control this process, and we fully welcome that. But I would take a moment to just quickly just do on the Afghanistan-Pakistan piece. Again, we talked about CASA already. The reality is that in the sort of spirit of Fred Starr's, you know, actions, not words, you know, we've spoken to both sides, and we know there's an interest in moving on things like border security and standard operating procedures on the border and other coordination mechanisms that frankly had broken down over the past few years, and that we will do our part from ISAF, from the U.S. government and our embassy in Islamabad to promote, but really getting that Afghanistan-Pakistan coordination across the board, economic, political, security, I think is an important task that both governments have said to us they prioritize and will put front and center. Thanks.
Yes, Mr. Shah.
I want to add something. I think I agree with Mr. Carpenter related to that we have to work on different grounds, on economic grounds. So we have to evaluate what are the bigger benefit and what are the lesser benefit, and how can we achieve the greater benefit by sacrificing the little benefit? How can we avoid on regional level? And how can we avoid the greater dangers by taking the little risk? So similarly, that regional project is one of the CASA, TAUPI, another project which are in the pipeline, but still it is, we have to work more. The second things which is happening in these days related to the peace issues. So President Ghani, when he was inaugurating, the President of Pakistan came and he visited and he invited him and he accepted in principle. This is one indication related to work on peace issues. The second thing is that his first visit be actually before the Pakistan, he will be visiting Saudi Arabia for Umrah, and probably he will be visiting the officials. So the Saudi Arabia is also effective in peace process. So I think there is intention of the government. So just I want to add one more thing related to optimism.
Yeah.
You know, when we want to build something, there should be some factors. Number one, good intention that we are doing this thing. Number two, we have to have a goals. Like maybe Korea or something, better goal is better than the excellent goal. Putting a big vision is better than looking very small. The third thing is proper planning and mobilization of all domestic and human resources. And the third part is that moving together. So I think Korea is the nation not, they do not have four eyes and Afghan has two eyes. And we can do that one. We have to, and that is not no matter. Maybe we in 50 years or in 100 years, but we have to have a vision. We are not saying that we will be, tomorrow will be, we will do these things. But continuous effort. Thank you.
Thank you. These were almost like final words, but optimistic final words. But I have Frederick wanting to say a word on the Taliban issue, and then it's getting tight because I can only take one short round of questions. And so that we don't exceed time. Frederick, please.
I disagree with the question because I think all four speakers and the program as a whole is directly dealing with the Taliban. Why? Because it's talking about jobs. Now, there's been, Jonathan Carpenter alluded to the fiscal gap. There is a jobs gap, and people need work. And this is exacerbated not just by the departure of international forces, but also by the reduction of international non-governmental aid and assistance. This is creating a huge jobs gap. Leif Rosenberger, who is a wonderful government-based economist in at CENTCOM, compares this to East Timor. And when the international assistance plummeted in East Timor, the country came apart for several years. So this is deadly serious. That's what this is all about. Now, what puzzles me, given the gravity of this, is that there's not been a focused bridge program on jobs. And it seems to me the obvious way to go is a public works program. This can be useful in any part of the country. It could be very limited in term, maybe for 2 years, say, 3 years maximum. Public works to build things that need to be built and give people very modestly paying jobs, but jobs. That's the alternative to Taliban.
One question.
Excuse me, but I have to take two or three questions, then each of you will get the word.
One question is unanswered, actually.
Which one? Investment question. That's correct. The question on investment and with a specific view to economic inequalities, as you, the young lady termed that. Okay, I'll give you.
I can speak to this very fast, Martin. And let me just say this. I mean, I think our program, our assistance program, working close in conjunction with the Afghans now for a number of years, has been shifting to less stabilization and more development. And big part of that is in the agriculture sector, right? Where the majority of Afghans get their employment. So from a perspective of economic inequality, yes, there's been a lot of focus on INAC and Hajigak and these massive investments, right? But the reality is that the majority of work is in the agriculture sector, and the Afghans have prioritized it. We've done a lot to promote, you know, broad increases in irrigated land and other access to this, in conjunction, frankly, with the Ministry of Women's Affairs, to make sure that that this is both, this has a gender component to it as well. So this is a big component of what we do, and it's an Afghan priority. So we're going to focus on these big, kind of capital heavy projects, and talk about those, and those are important. But I think it's important in this context to realize that there's a lot of other work going on here.
Okay. And I will give you the floor one more time, and that will be the final round at the same time. These are too many. We have a few minutes left. I have three questions that I'm still going to take, and there is the gentleman with the blue shirt behind, and then I give one more chance for each speaker to say a few words which must both be possible answer to questions and your final remarks, because more time we have not. So please.
Yes. Hi, Bill Bird from USIP. One question and two quick comments. The question relates to money laundering, and I think at some point the UAE ambassador might have been on the panel. We talk about Kabul Bank. UAE has not cooperated with Afghan government requests for that. So I'm wondering, in this whole process, did this kind of issue come up at all? My first comment is, and I guess this is to Dr. Ackerman more, to be a little cautious about how much you demand of the new government. This was very heavily mediated and influenced by the international community, and it's a very awkward and fragile arrangement. I know the principals involved on the Afghan side really are going to try to achieve progress, but let's not forget that to some extent this national unity government was imposed by the international community. And third point, just to complement that point of disagreement with an agreement with Ambassador, I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous to promise in advance to get to move out all foreign troops by 2016. This is, and if you look at South Korea, we can debate about that, but yes. In South Korea, there was a specific announcement of reduction of aid over time, and that spurred them toward export-led development. The security guaranteed remained even now, and similarly Taiwan. So this idea that somehow you get rid of the security forces and you try to maintain aid, it raises all kinds of issues. And third, the irresponsibility of announcing it during a presidential election campaign in Afghanistan almost boggles the mind. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I was going to cut that off because we have no time for comments, but I think the last comment was a very important one, and a very interesting link to Frederick's comparison with South Korea. And if I'm not mistaken, US troops are still in South Korea today.
Yes.
Okay. That. We don't want to count the years since the Korean War, but this may be something like 60-something. Okay. Shinwari, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Shinwari, not Muzamil Shinwari, but I'm Shinwari from the EastWest Institute, working with EastWest Institute. My question is to Mr. Carpenter. You know, most of these regional projects like ASA 1000, TAPI, investment in Afghanistan, trade and transit, these are all huge projects and have been discussed for the last three decades, to implement them. But I believe some of these projects need a very stringent and, committed leadership from the United States as well, for example, the agreement between Afghanistan and Pakistan was discussed for a long time, and it was signed when Hillary Clinton went there. So what critical leadership role the American can play, to make these projects happen and make development in Afghanistan sustainable? You can do a public work to some extent, constructing a bridge or something, engaging youths, but at a short term, Afghanistan need a sustainable economic development. And my question is, what critical role you can play post-2014 to make that happen? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry. The last question will be the lady in the back. If you keep it very short, please.
Okay.
I'm sorry. That was the other one. That was earlier than
me.
You mean the one that was much earlier? I'm corrected. Okay.
Okay.
By my coach, very able coach. Please go ahead then. No, I'm sorry, that's a misunderstanding. It's the young lady here in the front.
Okay.
I'm so sorry.
Me? Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
It's you.
So my question.
I apologize again. Please. Just a brief question. No, no more comments.
My question is related to Fritz's answer, creation of jobs. It's a very important, especially with the leave of international community. Afghans have lost their jobs. And a lot of these youth, they have to support their families. And in that situation, there are no jobs and they don't have any other options, not to dramatize it, but they might connect with Taliban because they need the money. What recommendations do you have to for this situation?
So, thank you very much for these questions. We have no time for a full hour of questions. What we'll do now, I will just refrain from the summary that I prepared. I will perhaps give only one remark, and that is that if I was in the Afghan government, I would probably spend a whole working day in just reading the recommendations that the international community gives to me, and then have no time to implement them. So that is, so I think what was said, the Afghan government needs help in many ways, but also in really prioritizing on a very few recommendations so that low-hanging fruits can be harvested. That's just a personal comment. I will not give my personal summary that I've taken notes for here. What I will do, I will give each speaker 1 minute for a last comment, which may be either a question, answer to the question raised, but questions can also be asked and responded to in the coffee break. But I would ask each of you, is there anything that you would like that you really think, okay, that is interesting, that came up today, that's something we must have a follow-up on? And I would start next to me with Philip Ackermann.
Thanks. I'll be very brief. Let me just take up what you said on the question of how much is the international community involved. What we have seen, I think I'm convinced by the fact that the Afghans want a government of national unity. They want it because they see their necessity. And even the political actors want it. Why do we have such a big international involvement in mediation in getting there? Because there is a lack of capacity. And this is one of the key words for Afghanistan, is capacity building. It is frightening to see that in 20 years' time, 25 years of wartime, all the capacities are gone, basically. You start from scratch, whether it's agriculture, you know, I have a special case with sugar industry, which I can tell you in the coffee break, but even to negotiation and how to set up a government. I think that's what we need to do. We need to escort or accompany the Afghans in these capacity building efforts on various levels, and that includes also mediation on this. I'm pretty confident that this national unity government can work, but it needs a hand from outside, and that's where we are happy to, if the Afghans want it, we are happy to extend this hand. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Philip. Jonathan.
Thanks. I guess I will, I'll close by sort of taking just broad issue with this idea that the United States isn't going to stay the course in Afghanistan. And I think there's so much focus on the president's troop commitments and troop decision. I think it belies a broader engagement by the United States that is both in security assistance funding, in a robust civilian assistance program. The case for which we have to make here, right? And you can't take any of this for granted. Our own fiscal situation at home is tight. So you have to make the case, as I think many of the commenters did today, on why this is in our interest. And three, I just, you know, again, take issue with this idea that somehow on January 1st, 2017, you know, our civilian presence and our interest in Afghanistan is going to look like, you know, our normal, you know, an embassy in any other country in the world. It's not. And if you've been to Kabul and you've seen, you know, what we're planning for in terms of a civilian presence, it is significant. If you've seen the requests we've sent to the Hill for assistance, they're significant. And I think my last comment to the issue of regional projects, you know, we absolutely are committed to using our diplomatic capital to move these forward. But, you know, I walk away from this with the word sustainability in my mind, whether it's a, you know, public works program or anything else. For these things to be sustainable, they have to be led by the governments of the region, first and foremost the Afghan government.
We should not, none of us are constraining their ambition. They can be as ambitious as they want, but it has to be their ownership. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Shah.
Just related to this, when we are talking about Afghanistan and abroad, the people think that Afghanistan means war, Afghanistan means killing. It is not like that. There are people living there. There are such type of event which is happening in the United States that is happening in Afghanistan. But meanwhile, we know we are fragile states. The other motives for, so there is opportunity to invest. The other motivation factor is that when you compare the profit margin is very high, even it is associated cost is high. If you compare, that profit may be greater than the low profit with the low cost in other regions. So that will also be make it motivation. And there is where how to that American investor or other investor can invest in Afghanistan. So we can talk in a private meeting as well.
Thank you very much, Mr. Shah. Frederick.
You can't talk about economic development without first talking about security. That's a law of nature. It works there, and it's relevant everywhere in Central Asia and the Caucasus. We don't get it. Now, on the way forward, it seems to me we're talking about human nature. Babe Ruth pointed to the fence and then actually hit the ball over the fence where he pointed. That's what's needed in this situation, to identify an objective and to attain it. It can be first something quick, like a public works program, limited time. But then it should be things that are already half there, like the implementation of the Afghanistan-Pakistan Transport and Trade Agreement. That's signed. It's a good piece of work. Another one that's almost there, and that is fast borders. We're not talking about 50 borders. We're talking about 5 or 6. Those could, if they're sped up, announce that you're going to speed them up. Every person producing anything, farm or factory, will benefit from it. Third, longer term, strategic. TAPI. Everyone knows about TAPI. We've talked about it for 20 years. You can't just endlessly talk about it. Either say you're going to do it and provide the leadership or get out of the way. Fourth, it has to be talked about now in the planning stage and financing, railroads. This is a long-term project. If it needs to get underway at the planning and financing stage right now. Now, do these things in an orderly way. Don't try to do 50 things. Announce that you're doing it, and when they're accomplished, let the Afghan public know that they've been accomplished. That will create the atmosphere in which further progress is necessary. That seems to me an entirely attainable set of objectives for the next 10, 15 years.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, John. Frederick, that's about the kind of summary that I had in mind, but you have done it much more eloquently than I could have done. I didn't want to stop you from applauding. I only wanted to ask you to include in your appreciation all the panelists. I think I have done an excellent job here. I would, from my side, like to include into my gratitude you, the audience, which is an outstanding audience. I apologize, we didn't have enough time for all of the questions. I also want to include the USIP as a host, and also my colleagues from the EastWest Institute who have worked very hard to make this event possible. Thanks once again for your participation, for your cooperation, for your contribution, for your interest. We have 10 minutes for the coffee break. We have to keep it short. I suggest that we reconvene at 10:50. Thank you.
Okay, I think we have a critical mass in the room to begin the second session We have a very strong panel to continue the discussion that was sort of framed and laid out this morning. I wanted to make two points of introduction, which the first one being that I think it was a Norwegian scholar who had pointed out one of the, I think, key dynamics of the regional relationship, which is for, you know, all of the countries in the region, Afghanistan is important, and attaining a sort of a win-win outcome that we've heard about this morning, you know, would be beneficial. But for each of these countries also, Afghanistan is not the highest issue on their foreign policy agenda, so it's easy for the default mechanism to be a lack of cooperation. And in order to attain this win-win, sort of more concrete decisions are taken, which I think has been the point of the East-West Institute's initiative so far. And again, some very concrete actions that were discussed this morning need to be done. And there needs to be the sort of political will, which is a phrase that I don't like, but sometimes you can't really do without it. And the question of political will relates to my second point, which is I remember in the summer of 2010, I was with the UN in Kabul, and we were preparing for the Kabul conference, which I think was held in August of that year. And we were drafting the communique that would come out of the conference, as usual among, you know, a small group of diplomats. The main representative of the Afghan government was Ashraf Ghani at the time, and of course he took a look at this carefully developed and negotiated piece of paper and said, we have to start over. This is worthless. And a few of us went into a small room where he began to dictate, and my job was to type what he said. And the first thing he said was, you know, this idea of Afghanistan as a roundabout of Asia. He said, we can't use the word roundabout because Americans don't understand what roundabouts are. That's a British thing. So maybe you're a hub of Asia or a turning plate of Asia. And so we're just going through all of these words, I think all of which have, you know, somehow been used in speeches over the years. But basically, it was clear 4 years ago that this was somebody who was committed to this vision of Afghanistan as a center of regional development. And so that part of the political will, I think, is there on the Afghan side. And the East-West Institute and others are sort of trying to do the heavy work of developing it among the other partners. So we have a panel here with representatives, not necessarily official, but formal and informal, from Afghanistan, from Pakistan, from India, and from the U.S., who can maybe help us solve the coordination and cooperation problem that so far has impeded this dream of regional integration, which, as Dr. Starr said earlier, has been around for 20 years, but hasn't made much real progress. Before getting to our representatives from these countries, I'll go first to USIP's resident economist and therefore pessimist, Bill Byrd, to sort of frame the issue from maybe an economic perspective.
Thank you, Scott. I think I will be making some fairly critical remarks. So I'd like to first talk that just underline that this is really an excellent report and a good initiative. And it's particularly good that it's concrete and it tries to prioritize, which, as has been said earlier, is a very important and difficult task. And I like very much what Professor Starr was saying, to move from talking to doing. Of course, now I'm going to be talking anyway. But so my remarks are going to raise some challenges and issues, but I think they need to be seen in this overall context, that this is certainly a good report and a good initiative. And also, many of my comments are touched on, at least in the report, but I think the mix and the weighting of some of them perhaps needs to be changed. First, I think the centrality of geopolitical fault lines and political economy, interest groups and distortions really needs to be kept in mind. It doesn't mean, you know, don't treat them as an excuse for inaction, but if you're not informed about them, then the project will be very unrealistic. They already mentioned many of them, the Indo-Pakistan, that's key. It's always going to be a constraint unless there's real progress on that. the old Cold War Iron Curtain, which I guess I date myself by remembering, still Central Asia and Afghanistan, and via Afghanistan, South Asia, they trade much less. Generally, the South Asia region and Central Asia regions trade much less among themselves than most other regions in the world. And let's not forget Iran. I think the report is a little bit downplaying Iran. It is mentioned here and there, but it's really, there's not a chapter on it. There's not sort of a major thing. And I do think, if you're looking at this region and you're not talking about Iran, that's sort of ridiculous. It's a big trading partner with Afghanistan. It also provides a good bit of electricity to Afghanistan in the western part. And it's certainly a potential competitor on some of the trade routes. If you just look at the map north to south, you can go through a lot less mountains by going north to south via Iran than by Afghanistan. And so, for example, on the gas pipeline, which I'll also talk a little bit about, it would seem much easier to send the gas pipeline through Iran than through Afghanistan. So it's a potential competitor on some of these sort of regional and or long distance routes. And of course, the other thing which people would always mention, it's a potential political spoiler in some of these things. So the idea that you can somehow talk about this region and really not give a central focus to Iran seems a bit odd. I mean, I'm not saying it's the most important one, but it's certainly not the least. And so the key question, I think, is not to be ruled by these constraints, but how to move around them and forward. And, there were different initiatives, and certainly the Afghanistan-led RECA process always included Iran, for example. I don't know about the Istanbul process, but I sure hope it includes Iran. It's just sort of so obvious. Another one I didn't even mention was the drug trade, the role of Iran as a transit point for drugs. So how to get through this, and I think the report talks about this, is you can make small moves at the margin and then look for breakthroughs sometimes. It seems like the prospect for CASA 1000 have improved. That's wonderful. It seems to me, and others could correct, that TAPI is getting bogged down a little bit. So the point is to have a few of these options on the table and then see which one can move forward quickly, not to be fixated on one or two of them to the exclusion of others. And on the other hand, not to have 40 projects, but also not to put all the eggs in one basket of one project. Another point I'd like to make, which I think is maybe partly in the report, but also certainly in some of the warning comments, this idea that Afghanistan's natural resources are a tremendous asset and wonderful. I mean, economists cringe at it, not because of pessimism, or there is a term called resource pessimism, but countries with heavily oriented toward natural resources generally have not developed as well as countries without them. And there's very strong cases why Japan was forced to engage in manufactured exports because of a lack of natural resources. And similarly, South Korea, not having natural resources, probably avoided it, some problems which other countries ran into. So in Afghanistan, in addition to the resource curse, which is actually called that by some economists, there are also issues, it's not well located. There's not a nearby port, all kinds of transport and logistical issues. So I think the message generally from a very extensive literature on natural resources and development is that natural resources plus very strong institutions, like in Norway, or interestingly, like in Botswana, seem to work. Natural resources without those institutions, Nigeria, for example, can be an absolute disaster. And so, so I think we need to be cautious that somehow having $1 or $3 trillion of resources is going to make Afghanistan into South Korea. I think it's really a dangerous notion, and actually the ground is much more for caution on the resources. Another one where it's a bit unrealistic, and I'm not sure the report is endorsing this that much, but the idea that somehow containers with bulk goods or with any kind of goods will go from Moscow to Delhi overland through Afghanistan, that doesn't seem to be right in terms of the economics. The sea route, which were discovered, in the 15th century, are much more efficient and will remain so. So be very careful. And by the way, if you want to look at a land route north-south, maybe not quite so far, but something that's economic, again, it just looks much more easy from a variety of perspectives to do that through Iran. However, and I think this is really important, there's large potential for what you might call local, intra-regional trade. As I said, these countries don't trade, other than Pakistan, Afghanistan, which is different, the other countries don't trade that much with each other, especially Central Asia with Afghanistan. And so I think there's a lot of scope there. But again, not wanting to be overly ambitious and look for the 5,000-mile container traffic, but look, see if you can open a bridge between Afghanistan and Tajikistan, as was done a few years ago, and you start developing local trade. And then the important points about that Professor Starr made about borders and managing them, very important. Infrastructure investments have been helpful. I think in the morning they talked about that. But I think we have to remember that without maintenance, infrastructure can deteriorate extremely rapidly, and that's happening. And also due to security incidents, for example, on the Kabul to Kandahar road. So infrastructure is really important, but I don't see much signs that there is a good prospects for maintaining it. Water. I was first going to say maybe Iran is the elephant in the room, but that doesn't seem appropriate. I think water might be the elephant in the room in this process. It's something people don't want to touch. President Karzai at one point forbade discussions of riparian water issues because he felt this is Afghanistan's water and any negotiations with neighboring countries would be wrong. That's obviously an extreme and ridiculous position, as is the position that I've heard from the Pakistan government that no international projects on the Kabul River without essentially a veto power by Pakistan. So there needs to be dialogue here, but I did feel the report a little bit was underplaying this issue. I don't know whether it was because it was thought to be unimportant, which I think is wrong, or simply because the political constraints were felt to be too great. Regional cooperation, again, I think this is not inconsistent with the report. The best term for it is spaghetti bowl. There's many, many organizations overlapping, unclear responsibilities. They sap the energy and the limited capacity of the countries, especially Afghanistan. It would seem to make sense to focus on the Raqqa Istanbul process, which seemed to be moving well, and then basically, without saying in so many words, just ignore a lot of the others. And I think very important point, which I think came out in the morning also, that regional cooperation could be synergized and could complement Afghanistan's development, but it's by no means a substitute. So we need to keep the focus on Afghanistan's progress in coming years while using regional levers as a tool to help both in that and build regional cooperation, but not to reverse that and put regional cooperation before or as a substitute for Afghanistan's development. I can't resist a last comment, if that's okay. South Korea, I think, for a variety of reasons, is not the right example. And I actually would challenge Professor Starr's point of view that somehow Korea's education system was terrible in the 1950s. Pretty much, I think the East Asian model was on high levels of literacy and trained, relatively decently skilled, trained, very low-cost manufacturing labor. That's how the East Asian miracle occurred, or that was what fueled it. And Afghanistan doesn't have that formula. We could quibble about, but literacy rates, I mean, I haven't gone back and looked. I didn't have time because I didn't between the sessions, but it just seems to me to compare the education system and literacy rates in Korea in the 50s with Afghanistan now, I'm pretty sure Korea would come out better. I think the better example is, and I'll be very controversial, is Switzerland. And people may say that's totally ridiculous, but no, it's not. Switzerland's a landlocked country, and I think actually colleagues from Europe will know this much better than I do. But Switzerland, for centuries, was a really backward country in Europe. And I think at some point in the 19, I mean, A, they were a source of mercenaries, which generally is a sign that it's a poor country with a lot of unemployed young males who are seeking employment elsewhere. So the Swiss guards at the Vatican were just one example. It was very common. And somebody told me, and I'm happy to be corrected if it's not true, that in the 19th century, the term Swiss actually meant some kind of low-cost migrant labor. And so maybe Switzerland is a model for Afghanistan when the region around Afghanistan is getting close to as developed as Europe was in the 19th century. Because in the 19th century, the Swiss got their act together. Political reforms, they built up the watch industry, which they stole from the British. You know, I mean, not stole is not the right word, but they were able to take over the watch industry, which Britain had dominated, and they were quite successful. And then to become a financial and money laundering hub, which I guess we're not recommending that for Afghanistan, but UAE already pretty much plays that role. But my point being, there are, you know, a landlocked country, and in Switzerland, you know, the key thing was the neighborhood, right? I mean, the neighborhood you're functioning in, Europe was the powerhouse of development in the 19th century, and Switzerland took advantage of that very well with some astute political thing, difficult coalition politics among cantonments, very decentralized. So that would be the kind of model, but just that may be a model, you know, in coming centuries rather than in coming months or coming years. Thank you.
Bill, I was going to thank you for over-delivering on the pessimism, but then you ended on, you know, a surprisingly optimistic comparison. Let's move now to Ambassador Kagahel. As a former Pakistani diplomat, also I think we'd be interested in, obviously, your views of how Pakistan sees this complex regional integration question, and maybe also something specifically on the transit trade agreement, which was signed to great fanfare, I think, in 2011, but we keep repeatedly hearing that it's not really being implemented. And I think there's some issues of trust and other practical issues that maybe you can help us understand.
Thank you. Well, it's a great pleasure for me to be here. I'd just like to say a few words about the process, the consultations that were organized by the EastWest Institute over the past 2 years. I think there have been hundreds of meetings on Afghanistan organized by scores of institutions and United Nations agencies and others. But these consultations had some distinct features. They were focused. They focused on the key issues of Afghanistan's likely role as the essential land bridge between Central Asia and South Asia and beyond. They talked about the question of energy trade, energy corridors, and the question of investments. These are all core issues in terms of both Afghanistan's resilience and development, and in terms of the feasibility of regional cooperation in the two regions, Central Asia and South Asia, for which Afghanistan plays or can play a crucial connecting role. And I understand that apart from preparing this report, which has the key recommendations, the East-West Institute intends to follow up on those recommendations and focus on the role of the private sector, and also on translating some of the talking into actions. And I hope that they will get the requisite support and resources for carrying on this important exercise. In any case, I think the recommendations that have emerged will serve as important inputs for all the efforts that are being made. The second point that I'd like to make is that Afghanistan has to necessarily go through these three transitions: political, security, and economic and financial. And there has to be a fourth transition or development, which is that the regional countries have to do more than they have done so far. And in that, my own country, Pakistan, India, is important, are important. And on the other hand, Iran, I think Bill Byrd quite rightly focused on the key role that Iran can play. And of course, beyond Iran, the Central Asian countries and Russia, these are important, important partners. Now, as I don't work for the government, but I had an opportunity of talking to my former colleagues. In Islamabad, there is a lot of optimism. The recent momentous decisions at the end of September have generated a tremendous optimism in Islamabad. And people in Islamabad claim that they were also instrumental. First, they did everything they could do to facilitate the process of election. And second, the agreement, the landmark agreement that was reached between Mr. Ashraf Ghani and Abdullah Abdullah. Islamabad was the first country, I think, that warmly welcomed that agreement, which led to the decision the decision of the two main leaders to form a government. As we all know, the United States had played a great role in that in July, after there were serious worries about one of the candidates going ahead with unilateral actions with some kind of orange and green revolutions and all that. And Islamabad has also kind of expressed support for the signing of the two agreements, BSA and the Status of Forces Agreement, and saying that Afghanistan was well within its right to sign these agreements. The Pakistanis made a special gesture, the participation of the president in the swearing in of Mr. Ashraf Ghani was meant to be a political statement. they speak, my colleagues in Islamabad speak of opening a new chapter in their relations with Afghanistan after the departure of President Karzai. Although they tried, the present government claims that their position on Afghanistan has been evolving in the direction of having no favorites, and that all that they want to see is a stable, peaceful Afghanistan that is able to ensure continued socio-economic progress in the country and also serve together with Pakistan as the essential land bridge between Central and Southern Asia. What we basically need is the first, as I said, the three transitions. I think it's no use talking about economic opportunities and job opportunities without security. We saw in 2012-13 that economic activity virtually came to an end. Work on both the mining projects, the Hajigak and Anak, so virtually stopped. Industrial and even agricultural activities suffered, and the job market suffered. So contrary to the World Bank prediction of 5%, the GDP growth actually came down to less than 3%. And you had also a drop in the real estate prices in Kabul and a corresponding increase in the real estate prices in Peshawar, in the suburbs of Peshawar, Hyatabad and others. And there were more Afghans leaving Pakistan for Afghanistan for Pakistan with the intention of not returning. So I think the importance of security as the foundation, as the essential prerequisite for economic activities that should not be, undermined. So we need these three transitions, the political transition, and we have had very encouraging developments. There are no fundamental policy differences between Mr. Ashraf Ghani and Abdullah Abdullah. I'm also delighted to say that both of them met the president of Pakistan and both of them. In fact, Mr. Abdullah Abdullah spoke more eloquently about his intention, about his preference for good relations with Pakistan. So these are hopeful sort of things. And the economic and financial transition, I think there are good prospects, but Afghanistan's future development, and as well as the possibilities of regional cooperation, they are feasible, but not preordained. They will require actions by Afghanistan, by each one of the regional countries, and in the regional framework, and the support of the international community. The three actors are Afghanistan itself. The Afghan government will have to deal with the serious questions of corruption. I think Mr. Sopko's report has been circulating throughout the world, and it will be essential institutions of governance. The foundations have been laid in the past few years, but those have to be, we have to have robust state institutions to carry forward the process of economic development in a world where there will simply not be the kind of monies that were available in the previous decade. And so these three transitions, plus the positive role of the region, and if Afghanistan is able to develop these robust governance institutions, if the regional partners play their due role, India and Pakistan have to try to put their act together and to avoid projecting their historic rivalry in Afghanistan. There have been complaints on both sides, and those complaints have to be addressed. And the international community must engage with Afghanistan, continue to engage, and we hope, there are positive signs. Now, both the consultations as well as the international, there is consensus on three concrete initiatives: the Pakistan-Afghanistan Transit Trade Agreement. There is slow but steady progress on that. We know that Pakistan has to do a lot to improve its infrastructure between Peshawar and Karachi, improve the formalities, the custom formalities in Torkham and as well as in Karachi. And Pakistan seems to be willing to do that. The Central Asia, South Asia, CASA, 1,000, which is actually 1,300, because 300 megawatts will stay back in Afghanistan, and 1,000 megawatts will be transmitted to Pakistan. There is good progress. Last week, I think it was on Friday, here in Washington, the price agreement was initialed. And the same goes for TAPI. TAP had no problem. It was the I which had the problem. But I think all the enabling agreements have been agreed upon, and we hope that TAPI will also be possible. I think there is a greater willingness now in India to continue to work for this project. So we are cautiously optimistic, and we hope that the positive trends can be and will be consolidated in future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And also a very useful reminder, I think, that, as you said, we're all relieved that the political standoff over the election was resolved peacefully, but there was a tremendous economic cost that people like Bill have written about that was exhibited through certainly private sector activity that stalled or even reversed. And I think that's a good segue to Ambika Sharma, who wrote the paper on harnessing Afghanistan's economic potential in this report, and also deals very much with the private sector, and can maybe help us also understand what India and India's private sector
Absolutely.
Can bring to this equation.
So thank you so much. And I would first like to thank the United States Institute of Peace and EWI for giving this opportunity to me. And I would just like to share with the members who are present and listening to these deliberations, perhaps for the first time, that East-West Institute has played a tremendous role in deliberating and bringing different stakeholders together, be it industry, be it security, be it foreign policy relations. So we all have worked together, deliberated over the last three meetings. And with a lot of pride, I would like to share with you that India, which the country which I am representing, we have played a tremendous role over the last 2 years, but that's not what has been done, but we are going to work consistently forward towards that direction. My points are going to be very different from what you have been listening since morning, and Professor Dr. Starr has already raised a very important issue, which is walk the talk, and that's what exactly we are doing. You all may be aware that Heart of Asia process, when it was initiated, India took a lead that how to commercially enable Afghanistan. And that's what we have been doing, because we do realize the importance of political security, we do realize the importance of other security issues, but economic security cannot be undermined. So I would just like to share with you a very underlying, a mission statement for us as far as rebuilding or reconnecting Afghanistan is concerned. We feel Afghanistan is definitely at a critical juncture in the remarkable political and security transition that is underway. But there is a lot more than simply looking at it from political and security terms only. We must not lose sight of the economic transition that is underway that requires the support of all the countries. India has taken that responsibility as part of the partner to Afghanistan. And I'm delighted to share with you that over the last 2 years, when we took this initiative, we have organized numerous capacity building programs, not only for the entrepreneurs, but also for the chamber officials, the government officials, more than 2,000 business to business meetings, really, which has generated a lot of interest among the Indian and Afghan businesses to work together. We have worked on separate programs to enable Afghanistan young entrepreneurs to understand the new technologies, the new innovation programs, and how to connect with them. And not only these programs have not only been implemented in India, but we have gone ahead and done these programs in Afghanistan. And I'm very happy to share with you that only next month, we are sending a team of 40 leading Indian companies to go and showcase the products. And not only the showcasing of products, but as to how India and Afghanistan businesses can work together. So we are creating an enabling environment to bring the businesses together. And we also run a very interesting program with USAID, which is called Millennium Alliance, which is a very inclusive platform to leverage India's creativity, expertise, and resources to identify and scale innovative solutions. Here, sir, you talked about water. You talked about utilities was talked about in the morning. So we are trying to bring about the knowledge of how the exchange of such technologies can take place and how we can support this huge cause which is waiting for a good technology solutions in the years to come. We are taking separate initiatives to harness the sectoral potential of Afghanistan. I'll just give you a very small example, marble. So we are giving the opportunity to Afghanistan industry to come and showcase what they can do for the rest of the world, be it exports, be it joint ventures. And this is a very, very baby step, but you know, it is making a lot of difference to Afghanistan marble industry. Similarly, we do an international conference, as it was talked about by one of the esteemed speakers from Afghanistan, that it is very important to showcase to the world there are a lot of questions in people's mind about corruption has been talked about. There are a lot of other issues have been spoken, the security of the investments. So we have been creating these enablers, and we did very successfully with the Afghanistan government a huge program on doing business with Afghanistan, because the world has to know the potential, the policy, and the rules, because there are problems, but it's not the end of the story, because there's a huge potential. And so it is important to share with the world and the potential partners as to how we can work together with Afghanistan. I'll just share with you a very simple example. We started working on capacity building program for the Afghanistan Chamber of Commerce, and we realized that they don't even have a B2B portal. So we have taken that initiative to have that B2B portal, which is going online in December. What is going to happen? It is going to enable the Afghanistan industry to connect with the people from the world, the people of business from the world, be it an access, how to access the international trade leads, the tenders and the projects. This is very important. So we took upon these very basic steps as to how enable the Afghanistan businesses to be ready to take more economic challenges. Before I close, I would just like to share with this the members who are present over there that from my organization, which is Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, we are representing more than 275,000 companies of India, which is one of the leading agencies. We have major two recommendations which have been talked about on to bring about the policy change. One is the Afghanistan as a transit trade and investment hub. We have been talking about Silk Route. So we feel that it is very imperative to harness Afghanistan's potential, not only as a bridge or roundabout connecting these regions, contributing only as a transit route, but as a possible driver of economic growth in the region with developments of its human resources, particularly its natural endowment, including minerals and hydrocarbon resources. We are very delighted to hear the progress on certain fronts, which have been shared by Ambassador Kakel from Pakistan. We are also very, we would be very happy that at the earliest, there should be a full implementation of the Afghanistan-Pakistan Trade and Transit Agreement, as well as its gradual extension to India. In this context, the proposed MOU between Iran, Afghanistan, and India on the Iranian port of Chabar to link Afghanistan with India is a welcome move. Our recommendations are very business specific. So we would also like to highlight that India, under the SAFTA process, has unilaterally offered to import duty-free and quota-free goods from LDCs, including Afghanistan. And we hope that other countries could also offer such concessions, as it would help to transform Afghanistan into a manufacturing hub. And that's the final goal for enabling Afghanistan to be ready to take challenges. And I would also like to touch upon another major policy recommendation which we as a business organization has taken up, is the energy corridor as a confidence-building measure and the engine of growth. Energy has been talked about by almost every speaker in one way or the other. And you will all agree with me that a regional energy trade could serve as a catalyst for economic integration and peace-building at the regional level, contributing to the settlement of violent conflicts. As a gateway from South Asia to Central Asia, we all know that Afghanistan holds a key position to unlock new economic potential in the regions by providing transit routes for energy supplies from Central Asia to energy markets of South Asia, a scenario with win-win potential for all the stakeholders. In terms of security concerns, special attention should be given to mitigating transit risks through Afghanistan. Measures to be taken include employment of local workforce and local regular access to supply of electricity and gas along the transmission routes. Special security measures to protect the routes, deployment of repair crews, and maintenance. In terms of funding, an intergovernmental regional trust could also be set up to cover such costs. So friends, these were all very business-friendly initiatives and business-friendly recommendations. And we are working with a lot of US businesses also with a very regular engagement with the final objective as to how we can strengthen Afghanistan economically. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Now for the Afghan perspective, I'm happy to welcome Waidula Waisi, who's a familiar face from many conferences. I see in your bio you've listed Berlin, London, Rome, Bonn, and so forth. And it reminds me of a line by Nabokov, who said that history was a process by which small European towns get turned into the names of international treaties. So I think modern history is where European capitals get turned into the names of to-do lists for the Afghan government. But I think we've all commented this morning on the opportunity that we now have with not only a new government coming out of an election, but also a dynamic one, and one headed by somebody who has very clear ideas on economic reforms and regional integration. So we look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Thank you very much. Most of the time, actually, when we were making these conferences and when we were together, they named us conferencists. So we were, for most of the time, we were conferencists because of 22 conferences, international conferences that we were making outside Afghanistan, and our department somehow, most of the time, directly involved in developing of the conferences. Let me thank USIP and EastWest Institute for putting this great work together, great job. I think the recommendations that has been published in this document is really fair and very on time for the new government. These are most of the issues that if you watch Dr. Ashraf Ghani's meetings with different groups of people from private sector to women to youth to ministries and other categories of institutions, he is always trying to find out recommendations for the new agenda of the new government. So this will contribute a lot, and especially the upcoming events. This is really helpful. Let me start from the events that we have in next 6 months. One of them, which is on 31st of October in Tianjin, China, is the Heart of Asia. Yesterday we had ambassadorial meeting, coordination sort of meetings to understand where our countries are with the CBMs, the confidence building measures. These are the core, the backbone of the Heart of Asia conference. CBMs they are focusing on six priority or pilot areas: education, trade, commerce, and investment, which Ambika just mentioned about it. The regional infrastructure, that most of the big names that you have here today, CASA 1000, TAPI project, and TUTAP, and some others, they're all part of the conference building measures, but This is mainly a political cap for the regional projects. Then we have counter-narcotics, counter-terrorism, and natural disaster management. These six CBMs, every country of the of our region somehow is leading one of these. For example, India is leading the TCI, the Trade, Commerce, and Investment. Together with other member Heart of Asia countries, and for example, education is led by Iran. Turkmenistan is leading the regional infrastructure. They have meetings, they have discussions, they are in talk and contact to each other. But the big question is: have we been successful so far? And implementation of the Heart of Asia recommendations or the CBMs, which has implementation plans. The answer to this question cannot be 100% yes or no, because we still have long way to go. You understand the nature of the Central Asian governments together with other countries which are in our region, 14 countries of Heart of Asia, different types of government set up, different types of cultures, different languages, different sorts of legal institutions and mechanisms, and coherency among all these countries are a big challenge, but not impossible. So this is something which is we put together. It's a long way to go. Conference building is not really an easy job, never been in the past, but so far some parts which are taking place, that has been remarkable. Then we have London Conference. The London Conference three major agendas are basically focusing on regional cooperation, the Tokyo Mutual Accountability Framework. The report has to be presented to the international community. And for the first time, they put private sector as a big agenda of the London Conference. So, and this is making a very good opportunity for national unity government to discuss with the international community its agenda, together with the sustainability of the process and activities that are successful and that will make some changes in the future. The other one we have is the United Nations Special Program for Economies of Central Asia. This consists of six regional countries, mainly Central Asia and Afghanistan. And Afghanistan is chair of the 2014 of SPICA. This is called UN SPICA in abbreviation, which has two formats, governance format and economic format. The governance, the economic format is mainly focusing on the major activities and major projects that we have already discussed here, and we'll talk. And then the last event which we have will be our sixth Regional Economic Cooperation Conference for Afghanistan, that consists most of the regional countries. It made a very good deal of regional projects, consensus building. In its last meeting that we had in Dushanbe in Tajikistan, and we introduced 17 regional economic projects. And the sixth one includes some new projects and the continuation of the projects that we still have. For example, CASA 1000, it has a calendar for it. I mean, the implementation time for CASA 1000 is 2017. So whatever you hear today, these are all based on the calendar that moves. And same for TAPI. TAPI implementation deadline is 2018. But today we are now in discussion with companies to absorb companies for investment, and that's the right place at the right time. It's moving, but it takes some time. So these are the four major events that I mentioned, and the major thematic issue of all these four is regional cooperation. So this is becoming a big deal, not only for Afghanistan, but for our neighboring countries as well. The National Unity Government yet to put together its economic plan, its more its strategy, its development agenda. We have got Dr. Ashraf Ghani's economic agenda or socioeconomic agenda at one hand before election, and also we had Dr. Abdullah's economic agenda. Now they have to come together and set a unified agenda together and develop a national agenda or national economic development agenda that will take place, of course, once the government shaping in next 2-3 weeks. But one thing is very very much important: that do we really need to write new agenda for Afghanistan? This is, you know, in past 10 years, which I have been involved. Not, you know, the conferences that I have been involved in, and Scott was talking about it, these were not about in making of the conference. It was more about coming together, putting together economic agenda, development agenda, socioeconomic agenda for at that stage to work together with the donor communities. So far we have written more than 1,000 pages, and those most of these activities are, have not been implemented. This is if we stick to the this morning's motto, that we stick with implementation, that's the time of implementation, and we have enough strategies. And even if you read something new, if you read something from government, these are not new. These are mostly rewritten or basically cut and paste of the past activities. So time for implementation is there, and we have to really encourage ourselves to contribute as much as possible into implementation of these activities. Engagement of private sector, this has been discussed, but if you really study the Central Asian countries together with Afghanistan and Iran, I'm not talking about Pakistan because Pakistan has a very good model of private sector partnership so far together with India, but in Central Asian countries and Afghanistan, we are really lacking experience of working together with private sector. This is something which needs to be a big deal for the new government. The public-private partnership is still not a policy in our country, in my country is. And in Central Asian countries, public-private partnership is a really, really something that they need to focus, except Kazakhstan, which they are now moving towards some great partnership with private sector, but the rest of the Central Asian countries which we are talking need to deal on trade and transit, that still requires some more more greater work. What exactly we are looking forward in future? I categorized them into three phases. Quickly, I'm going through them. National, at the national level, I mentioned about the new policy of the national unity government that they have to put together and prioritize the activities. Prioritization is a key element, rather developing of a new strategy at this stage. Dr. Ashraf Ghani have already ordered or assigned teams in different groups to start some critical work. For example, he has assigned the Ministry of Commerce and Ministry of Justice to review all economic laws and regulations that should be more friendly legislations for the private sector investment. So this is a very key issue. The Kabul Bank case, that is also building more confidence for investors. These are the activities which are happening right now. At the regional level, we have a big list of projects and activities. For example, I'm naming the trade and transit. At the trade and transit, the plan is to renew our existing agreements, trade and transit agreements, or develop new trade and transit agreements. These are part of the plan. Alternative routes. This is something which is really happening right now. We are in discussion with Turkmenistan, Azerbaijan, Georgia, and Turkey. And today in Baku is the second technical meeting of the Lapis Lazuli Corridor, which we call it Lapis Lazuli, to connect Afghanistan to Black Sea corridors or to Turkey through Bosphorus to Istanbul and to Europe. This is a new corridor on trade, transit, and transport. It's happening right now. The Chabahar, Ambika already mentioned, this serious discussions are going on between Afghanistan, Iran, and India, and we are encouraging other regional partners to join. The Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, we recently established some discussion to develop this corridor, which is the nearest way for Kazakhstan to go through Afghanistan to Chabahar. The cross-border transport agreement, this has been signed between Afghanistan, Tajikistan, and Kyrgyzstan. This is a very good model for, it's a multi-model and very good passageway to connect my country with, through Tajikistan and to Kyrgyzstan to China. Trasika, Afghanistan is on the stage of becoming member of Trasika. Trasika is the transport corridor Europe, Caucasus, and Asia. This is a multimodal corridor that makes coherent the trade and transit activities of the countries who are a member of the TRASICA. So this is happening right now at the trade and transit. On energy, you heard about CASA very much. This is a very it's a very good stage. TAPI is, I already mentioned about it, but I want to mention that, yes, TAPI, CASA 1002, TAPI, these are part of the confidence. Once CASA is moving, I think this builds the big momentum or confidence for the rest of the activities in the region. And on the roads, the railroad between Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, and Tajikistan, the two lines of railroads are now moving. The feasibility studies are happening, and some funds have been already allocated from EDB to construct the railroad. And the some other activities moving on, which concludes our regional agenda. And at the international agenda, briefly, I want to mention that we have got 18 strategic partnership agreements with the world so far. So where are we with these long-term strategic partnership agreements? This is something, a big action plan for the new government to move on. Every single strategic partnership agreement has economic and development component. For example, we only had one time meeting with on economic issues of the Afghanistan-United States Strategic Partnership Cooperation. So this, the momentum is now built, and there are more work is needed. So if all this works, if all this happening, Afghanistan will no longer be in a position to follow either Swiss model or South Korea model. It will develop its own model. So this is something which is happening, and we are very much hopeful for the future, especially with the National Unity Government. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I especially like that point about not needing any new strategies. I mean, as you say, there are thousands of pages of what to do. Now is obviously the time to do it. We will, I think, go until 12:15 because we started a little bit late. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our final speaker, Fatima Sumar, who is an old friend of the Institute from her days on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, but we're happy to have you here as your not-so-new role as Deputy Assistant Secretary for the Bureau of Central and South Asia.
Well, thanks, Scott. It's a real pleasure to be back here at USIP, and it's my favorite location next to the State Department in terms of moving about. So thanks first for having me back here, and thanks to the EastWest Institute for a really timely and I thought thought-provoking report. I had a pleasure of reading it over the weekend, and I thought it really struck a lot of the tone of what's already happening in some ways around the region, but gives us kind of a better roadmap for how to move this forward. So I thought, Scott, what I would do with your permission is kind of pull together some of the themes that we've heard all morning and see if we can kind of look at what a political roadmap looks like for the way forward out of this and building out of the recommendations of the report. And first I wanted to say one of the things that strikes me from where I sit, I cover regional affairs for South Asia and Central Asia, so I have a slightly wider lens, is that the political context here really matters. And it's not just about Afghanistan. It's about what's taking place in the broader region. It's looking at what's happening in Central Asia in the post-Ukraine aftermath, for instance, in the context of Russian moves on the Eurasian Economic Union, for instance, in terms of what China is trying to accomplish in terms of its own energy security and transport corridors, in terms of the future of what Pakistan would like to develop and see move forward in terms of connecting to the region, in terms of India's energy security needs and India's conversations. So there's a lot of different political movements on the stage beyond what's going on in Afghanistan, but they all tie together and will impact one another. And I think that political context here is really important as we think about the prioritization of how we move this forward. One of the things that strikes me is when we think about what's going on in the region, the overarching goal for many of these countries is security, stability, and prosperity. And it's not just for Afghanistan in this context, but they all kind of share that as an overriding objective. They will implement that in different ways depending on their own national and self-interest and what makes sense for where they sit within the region. Waheed made a very excellent point of you're looking at multiple countries and governments with different forms of governance structures, different types of civil societies, different types of private sector and industries. So part of when I look at my portfolio and thinking about what role the U.S. can play to help facilitate what's already going on in the region, because it is already going on. And I think that's another point I wanted to make, that actually what we're talking about here today is building off of the work that has been going on for many years. And it's not just starting today, and it won't just start in a Ghani government, but it's really building on the successes that we've had from the Afghans and from the regional community and the international community over many years. But there is a question of implementation, but also prioritization of how to move this forward. So we think about the key areas. I mean, one of the things that strikes me is that countries are going to move on different projects depending on what they need to complement what's already going on. So when the United States talks about its new Silk Road Initiative, which many of you have heard about for the last few years, what we are very serious about in the way we think about this is that the developing these new north-south corridors is about complementing existing east-west corridors of trade. It's not to supplement, it's not a zero-sum game of options, but it's to give all these countries, Afghanistan, Central Asia, Pakistan, others, different and additional economic options for how it can diversify its energy base, how it can diversify its economic and transport options. And increasingly, in a globalized world, when we think about increased in Asian interconnectivity, that's a key for market success. And we see that play out all throughout the world. And that's what I think is one of the things that resonates the most with many countries in this region, is that they understand the importance of economic diversification. Now, it has to be done within a security structure that makes sense for them, so that they don't feel that their borders are a source of insecurity or instability, but that they feel that they have enough confidence of what is coming across and transiting their borders brings more good than bad in a very simplistic way. And so we can't forget and divorce the security piece from this conversation. The other piece that I think has come up in a couple different points, but I think is worth us pulling together as well out of this conversation, is the energy water nexus. You've heard a lot this morning from different speakers about the energy nexus, but there is increasingly an energy water nexus of shared water throughout this region that will impact the future development of this region. And I think one of the things that deserves more conversation, and we're doing this a lot on the Central Asia side with our partners, and the UN playing a particular role in the World Bank as well, is transboundary water management, because Afghanistan's increasingly going to have an important voice and role to play on that stage, especially when you think about the waters in the north with Central Asia and the water sharing that is already going on but is not done within the kind of institutional frameworks that are going to be increasingly important for governing this space and deconflicting tensions over an issue that already raises tensions throughout the region. Let me talk a little bit quickly, because I'm conscious of time, of the United States kind of view on how we're taking this forward. We developed last year, the New Silk Road was an initiative launched under Secretary Clinton, as many of you know, in 2011. When Secretary Kerry came in as secretary, we took a hard look at what was already going on in the region and came up with a very streamlined and prioritized list of what the U.S. was going to focus on from 2014 to 2016. And, you know, at this point, it's four key areas that really build off of the work that's happening in the region. And it's done in an extensive partnership with our partners in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, Central Asia, with all the development community and the international community. The first is creating a regional energy market. It's striking to me, because if we had had this conversation a year ago, you would not have heard, I think, as much about the regional energy side as we're hearing today. And I think in part because momentum builds confidence, and you're kind of picking up on that on the themes. But you know, the three projects that we've been putting some time and effort on, first is CASA 1000, which is a World Bank-led project. The second is the two TAP connections, which is an Asian Development Bank-led project. And the third is TAPI. And on CASA, you know, I have to really credit Pakistan's leadership in particular, because one of the key lessons, and actually if there's any colleagues here from Harvard Business School or other business schools, I think CASA 1000 is a terrific Harvard Business School or another business school case study that is not yet, you know, yet to be written. So good assignment for some of you out there. But why did we have a breakthrough on CASA in the last year? It's because of political will and leadership from the four CASA countries, and from Pakistan in particular, when it signed the necessary framework agreement last September and took it to the next step so that all four countries were aligned. In the past year, you know, I've been privileged to have a chance to work with all these four countries. The amount of political leadership from the highest levels of government, in some cases the prime ministers, finance ministers, energy ministers all the way on down to work with the World Bank, to work with the CASA Secretariat, to work with the international community and donors to get this to the next level has been tremendous, because they see it's a window of opportunity that we have today, we may not have tomorrow. And so the signing that happened, the agreement that was reached Friday night, and the signing that took place Saturday morning at the World Bank between Afghanistan and Pakistan on the transit price, it was a really critical step forward. The next step now is to bring, to finalize the sell price, the commercial pricing agreement between the sellers, Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan, and Pakistan. And we're hopeful that that's only an agreement away sometime this fall as well, so that construction and procurement can begin on CASA. TUTAP is the other project, which I think is also interesting, not because it's a theoretical concept. Electricity trade is already happening in the region, right? There already is a regional energy market. Electricity flows currently from Turkmenistan, from Uzbekistan, from Tajikistan, down into Afghanistan. Increasing that supply, increasing the stability of that supply, and also looking at potential exporting to Pakistan is kind of the next step of this. So we're working with the Asian Development Bank, with other donors, to look at how we can further build on those lines. Turkmenistan, for instance, is building its line, building a brand new line. It's already under construction from Turkmenistan to the Afghan border. The next step, for instance, right now is to physically construct a line that will pick up from the Turkmen line that comes down to Poli Kumri to the substation that would then generate down to Kabul and throughout Afghanistan. So these are the kind of technical discussions that are actually taking place, you know, every week here in capitals all around the world, to think about the next steps of how to sequentially move this. In some cases, it's a lot of money. In some cases, it's not about money. It's about political will and leadership. And it's also signaling that there's a confidence that this can happen despite uncertainty over at times on the security environment. Let me switch really quickly to the other three pillars, because they've gotten less mentioned, but I think they're as important. The second is facilitating trade and transit. And here, the U.S. role has very much been one of support for the regulatory architecture, because we all know that you can build the physical infrastructure, you can build these multi-billion dollar investments, but unless you have the regulatory piece of this, the software of how trade works, very little is able to actually cross borders. And so here we're looking at the different types of successes we know that have to take place from other lessons learned from other parts of emerging economies and markets. A couple of things here that are really key. First is WTO accession. You know, in order to trade, we want to encourage communities and countries all around the world to be part of a global trading community, a rules of the road of the international community. Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan are already part of WTO. We have been working and are hopeful that Afghanistan will be able to join by the end of this year, early next year, and we've been working and supporting Kazakhstan's accession as well. But bringing more countries within this region into that framework is increasingly important. TIFA is another area where our colleagues at USTR have been working very hard over the last decade with countries in Central Asia, in Afghanistan, to think about the trade and investment frameworks that you would need in this region, both bilaterally and regionally, to support greater trade. Other mechanisms on a multilateral phase, which we've been looking at and supporting, joining the International Road Transport Union, joining TIER, looking at the different kinds of regulations you need so that if you build the rail line, your cargo can actually seamlessly transit from country to country because you're all part of the same international rail architecture, international road architecture, so that your trucks can cross your border. You know, I think NAFTA actually is a kind of an interesting parallel for a different way, which is, you know, in the 90s, we signed a very historic agreement on trade and transit within North America. It's only recently, as of this month, that Mexican trucks will be allowed to enter U.S. space, which is a huge breakthrough in terms of these negotiations. But that is the kind of context in terms of what you actually need for physical trade to take place in terms of the regulatory piece. Another is the cross-border trade agreements. Wahid talked about APTA and CBTA. Now that these agreements have been signed, ratification, for instance, on the cross-border trade agreement with Kyrgyzstan, Afghanistan, and Tajikistan, we are working with Bishkek and hoping that the parliament there can move on ratification on those fronts. The third pillar, very quickly, is customs and borders. Now, my unofficial bumper sticker for this would be open but secure borders, because we all know that no country in this region is going to keep their borders open and want to trade unless they see the benefits from trade do not come at the expense of their own physical border security. And that's clear throughout this region and frankly, throughout the world. And so we have a huge moment here within the international community working with countries on our own donor coordination and assistance to make sure that as our own programs are working, whether that's the US programs, EU programs, UN programs, and many, many other countries around the world, to look at how we actually seamlessly connect border security with trade facilitation. And that's easier said than done in many cases, because we have, in many cases, different implementing partners, different donors. You may have different streams of money that are connecting on the Afghan side versus the Central Asian side or the Pakistan side. And so that's an area where I think we can use this window of opportunity in the next 3 years to really push for an open but secure border model. The World Customs Organization can have a huge enabling environment role here in helping all these countries in the region think about how to do both trade facilitation and border security. And then the last thing I'll just say on people to people, which is our fourth pillar. To me, this is one of the most exciting pillars. It's already happening, and in fact, it fuels and gives us the energy for every other pillar what we're doing, because at the end of the day, this is about people. It's not about countries, and it's not about institutions. It's about people. And what we've been able to do working through USAID and our other partners is really bring businesses together, bring markets, and it's a lot of what Ambika talked about. We've been hosting trade fairs throughout the last couple of years in Almaty, in Islamabad, in Tashkent, in Mazar-i-Sharif, where we bring together businesses from the region that have never had an opportunity to meet each other before. And they do their homework ahead of time, and we're seeing, in some cases, $8 to $10 million of letters of intent and agreement signed during these moments, so that you do start seeing not maybe necessarily the large-scale container traffic, but the intra-regional potential that Bill talked about earlier, which can have such an unlocking potential in many cases, and showing that some of this stuff can work and creating different types of incentives. So let me just end by saying this is the hardest region in the world to work when it comes to unlocking greater interregional trade. And I don't want to kind of gloss over that in terms of the context of putting this out there. This is the least integrated region in the world, right? So Central Asia is slightly higher than South Asia, but not by much. Central Asia trades at about 6% of intra-regional trade. South Asia is about 5%. In some cases, intra-regional investments are less than 1%. The barriers are incredibly high to unlock. The good news is that success can be huge in terms of what we're able to accomplish, because the bar is so low in many cases. It's going to be generational. This is not a program that's going to succeed in 3 years or 5 years or 10 years. It is a long-term generational commitment to think about Asia in a different way, not just Afghanistan, but to think about the way Asia can trade in a different way. Because whether it's energy security, whether it's container traffic or trade, if you can think about a world in which Kazakhstan can trade energy down with India, that's a fundamentally different Asia, right? That means the conversation we're having 20 years or 25 years from now on how we think about Asia as a landmass is fundamentally transformed and different. So the work that has been going on is actually, I think, historic and transformative if we're able to reach some thresholds that are really important for critical tipping points. And I think we'll get there in some of these cases. But it does require, I think, a doubling down today of looking at where we can prioritize, where we can implement, and also where we can generate the necessary political will from the governments and civil societies and businesses in the region to cross the finish line. Thanks.
Thank you. Not only for giving the U.S. perspective, but also for having an excellent summary of the main themes, and for seamlessly going from NAFTA and Ukraine at the top level to the substation at Pulihumri and integrating all of that. Let's take, question here and one at the back, and we'll take these three questions. As I say, we'll try to go maybe for another, 10 minutes or so.
Thank you very much. My question is, there are these big projects we mentioned before, TAPI, CASA 1000, for example, trade agreements and all those things. I think to sustain or to create trust within the region, address geopolitical issues, one has to pilot some of these big projects. Start, for example, with CASA 1000, for example, import additional few megawatts of electricity from Central Asia to Kabul, and, for example, just give a few hundred kilowatts to Peshawar, just to show it to people that it works, pilot it. when it comes to, for example, trade agreements, you know, like just extend the current Afghanistan-Pakistan trade agreement to Tajikistan, you know, like engage that, just to pilot it that it works, you know, like, by doing these small pilot projects, it will create confidence, trust within the region, and finally, the region will be ready geopolitically to embark on these larger projects. So I think that is one of the key recommendations of the report of the EastWest Institute, you know, like, rather than talking big things, but taking small action, you know, like big words, small action. That is very important thing of deliverable of this report. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Dr. Brannick. I'm recently retired, so I've been in and out of Afghanistan since 2005. And I agree with Mr. Wasit. We've got enough plans out there. It's just implementation. The problem I see with the implementation is the capacity. You know, we have a dearth of capacity in Afghanistan. I'm the only American ever taught at Kabul University. So I know the quality of the students there and their potential, but we don't have the capacity building mechanisms in place. We give lip service to capacity. There's very little bit of money. The only thing that really wins over in Afghanistan is those big ticket items, you know. And we need to start concentrating. We've been in there for 13 years. We need to start building the capacity, human capacity, to be able to implement these things. Otherwise, they're sitting on the books, you know. And that needs to, you know, U.S. has great policies. I spent a lot of time with the Canadian Northern NATO Alliance to try to help them work on their plans. And everybody's talking about big ticket items. But yet the population is starving. So we're not spending any time trying to build, you know, subsistence living with them. So we got to start tearing down some of our plans and our lofty goals and get down. You know, this gentleman over here talked about hydroplanes, plants, you know, to bring electricity into communities. I mean, I could go on and on, but I've been in that country since 2005, in and out. You know, and so I really understand the dynamics. And our plans are all, you know, every one of the countries, every business plan we want to go, talks about the government getting involved in big ticket items. Sorry. I think one more and then just have a final word.
Hi, everyone. My name is Tabish. It's very short. My name is Tabish. I'm a fellow at NED, National Endowment for Democracy. Actually, I'm an election officer from Afghanistan. I was feeling very happy while Ambassador Shafakat was making comments on Afghanistan. Apparently, we, the Afghans and Pakistanians, seem to be very friendly when we are out of the country. I was asking a question that's looking to the extensively connected networks that you have back home with the diplomatic establishment there at home. How really the security-centric view in the diplomatic establishment has been changed? Looking to the past decade of diplomacy, still the policy of the jihad and two fronts, as Dilip Hero mentioned in his book, is out of the table or not? Actually, I'm sure of the capabilities of doing diplomacy and sharing the interest with our Pakistanian friends, and we need to find a way to live together. But the comments made by Excellency Ambassador seems to me, it was too good to be true, but hopefully I want to hear from you that, is it a shift from security view politics to a more civil policy toward Afghanistan? Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Abdul Hamid Kazi. I'm a civil structural engineer. I worked 2 years as a chief engineer for reconstruction of Afghanistan in 2005 and 2004. My question is to Mr. Vaisi. He mentioned about the 1,000 page of strategic plan, economic plan, whatever it is, but it was not in practice. We know that the last 12 years was a different issues in Afghanistan. But now the recent government, whether they are using the same resources, the same data that are money politician come to force and starts from scratches. That's the one question. The second question is the population of Kabul city. once it, Mr. Karzai announced that it was a garden of the city in that region in 2002 when we were there in a Society of Afghan Engineers, we organized a conference. But in 2008, the United Nations announced as the dirtiest city in the world, okay? So that affect the population of the city. When there is no job, immigration is going to the big cities, and especially the Kabul city. Can you, thank you.
Thank you. Let me start from the last question. Basically, what Joseph, you mentioned, it's, you know, the new government has its own right to really utilize the old versions of strategic policies developed already, and they are coming up with good recommendations, or they do start from scratch. But I don't believe on starting on the from scratch, because both Dr. Ashraf Ghani and Dr. Abdullah, they were member of the cabinet of the past government, and they were so much involved in developing of the national priority programs, the national development strategy of Afghanistan, the Millennium Development Goals. For example, Dr. Abdullah was involved. So this is something which they are very familiar with the nature and conditions of the overall development activities and planning procedure. And I think I what I understood that it's more for implementation, monitoring, and evaluation rather developing of the new activities. This is what I understand from Dr. Ashraf Ghani so far. This is something which is really required, and he's doing by himself, the monitoring and evaluation. This is this should be part of the big process, and that was a big gap in the past. So the accountability, the corruption issue, the transparency, they were all the key elements of the some negative improvements. So on the purpose of the purpose of Heart of Asia actually is building trust. Mr. Shinwari was talking about that we start small, then we make a role model for the future activities. I think do we have time to really start small? That's a big question. But the region, I think, yet need to know its quality and its potential. This is something which region really, our region really need to understand. Those countries who are really doing well, they have been able to utilize all their capacities for better development cooperation. This is something which we really need to do.
I just want to add that as I have been focusing, that economic transition is really underway, and we have to take a lot of steps which to enable the Afghanistan's small and medium enterprises to be more capable to take the global challenges and enable them with more efficiency. Thank you.
Yes, there was a question about whether there was a change in Pakistan's security-centered approach in its relations with Afghanistan. Well, of course, security is important. And Pakistan has had serious concerns. Mullah Fazlullah, for instance, has been in Afghanistan for a long time and continues to remain there. Similarly, Afghanistan has concerns. But as far as the Pakistanis are concerned, the official level, they told me their position has been evolving, and they have no favorites now. The operation that has been started by the Pakistan Army in June in Waziristan covers everybody. There are no favorites. There are no. It's a comprehensive thing. It's a part of a national consensus on fighting terrorism and people who believe in terror, terrorist sort of means to achieve their objectives. So we have this assurance, and I hope that the two countries can work together. We have a joint commission. We have a number of processes, and that should that should help. The other thing I think Bill Bird mentioned, which I wanted to answer about water, Pakistan has absolutely no reservation and in fact is very keen to work with Afghanistan on completing the Indus Water Treaty, because the Indus Water Treaty did not deal with the Kabul River, which is a very important tributary of the Indus, and the lands that my family owns are actually irrigated by the Kabul River. And the Kabul River replenishes the Indus water flows by as much as 25% when it enters the Atlantic. We have absolutely no reservation either at the government level nor at the non-governmental level, and we look forward to entering into consultations with Afghanistan on how to develop the resources of the Kabul River before the Kabul River enters Pakistan. If we have allowed India to have hydropower projects on the three eastern or western rivers before they come into Pakistan, why would we question that to Afghanistan? I mean, so there's absolutely no reservation, political, technical, or any other on the cooperation for harnessing the resources of water. By the way, Afghanistan has immense water resources, much better than India, Pakistan, or any of the South Asian countries. It only has to deal with all the four basins that it shares with the neighboring countries, and there is tremendous potential for that. The other thing is that sometimes it's often ignored how much Pakistan has done for Afghanistan. We continue to harbor 2 million Afghan refugees. 20,000 Afghan students are undergoing college education in colleges and universities in Pakistan, half of them on scholarships. And we also have 4 or 5 projects connecting, improving the roads, connectivity, and also educational and health facilities in Afghanistan.
Thank you.
So,
Bill, have they turned you into an optimist?
Well, thank you, and I'm actually very encouraged by your remarks, and I would suggest, I think something was missing from this was, to a large extent, water, and maybe EWI could take it forward a little bit in a very sensitive manner. There are enormous issues. I mean, I'm really happy to hear that, but right now Afghanistan uses 90% of the Kabul water river. Is there a realistic chance that that goes to 70-30 or something? This is huge, and it affects intra-Pakistan dynamics, because Sindh versus the other provinces is also a water issue within Pakistan. So I'm really glad to hear that it's possible to open dialogue. I don't think the status quo now, where 90% of Afghanistan, of the Kabul River water goes to Pakistan, is acceptable to Afghanistan. So there needs to be give and take. And I think there are win-win projects, including hydropower projects in the Kabul Basin.
Absolutely.
That can also provide electricity. And again, if there's a level of trust, then water conservancy in Afghanistan can actually help some of these problems like floods in Sindh. So I would be, I would sort of urge EWI to see what you can do. And Central Asia, just to say, I mean, the Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan issues on water. They have their own issues. Then there's Afghanistan, where almost none of the Amudarya water coming from Afghanistan is utilized within Afghanistan. Big issues there. And then there's similarly Iran, Helmand River. There actually is an agreement. It's the only one where there is an international agreement between Iran and Pakistan, but there's dissatisfaction on both sides about it. So I would urge this in a very sensitive and maybe low-key manner to start taking forward this issue. That was given rise by your very encouraging remarks. There are two questions which weren't answered, so I'll try to address them very quickly. On the lack of capacity, I think we shouldn't overstate that too much. Maybe I'm a bit naive, and maybe I worked mostly too much with the Ministry of Finance, but there certainly is capacity there. In 2002, the Treasury Department of the Ministry of Finance was dominated by foreigners. Now there are not many foreigners there, very few. So my point would be, I think the issue you raised is quite genuine, but it's also an issue of prioritization. You try to do too much and you don't get anything done. It's clear where the Afghan government had the incentive, because they needed to build that capacity in order to get revenues from aid into the budget. They actually could do it. And I think the issue is prioritizing and sort of building, but there's an awful lot of latent capacity, particularly among the younger generation, which I think, let's say, the Afghan government has not fully utilized. Kabul urban was another question, huge. issue. And it's very interesting why in Afghanistan development projects in rural areas have often, especially the national programs, have often worked better than the urban projects. I think it's very interesting because logistically you'd think it would be different. I think during the Soviet occupation period, the urban projects worked, the rural ones couldn't work because of obvious security reasons. Why in the current or in the last 10 years, the rural projects have often worked better? That relates to governance institutions, you know, how the municipalities function. I think this is a whole issue, and of course the urban pollution and environmental issues are extremely important. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Thank all of you for staying past the hour. Before concluding, I also wanted to thank my colleagues at the EastWest Institute for sharing this event with us and asking us to host it. I think that it became very clear from the both panels that there is an agenda for action, and there has been an immense amount of the thinking work which is done, and there are some possible wins up ahead, as Fatima in particular pointed out. And then finally, thanks to this panel for taking your time and sharing your thoughts. So a big round of applause for everybody.